Quorum being present, this town meeting is called to order. Please rise for the invocation to be given by Mr. Pacino, and that'll be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. Pacino? Thank you. Now the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Before I continue, can you hear me? Okay. Well, how about now?
How about this?
How about now? There we go. Okay, the clerk will now read the warrant.
In the name of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, you are hereby required to notify and warn the inhabitants of the town of Reading qualified to vote in elections and town affairs to meet at the Reading Memorial High School Performing Arts Center, 62 Oakland Road, in said Reading on Monday, September 12, 2016 at 7:30 o'clock in the evening. At which time and place the following articles are to be acted upon and determined exclusively by town meeting members in accordance with the provisions of the Reading Home Rule Charter.
Mr. Halsey moves that we dispense with the further reading of the warrant with the exception of the officer's return. Is there a second? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries.
By virtue of this warrant, I, on August 23, 2016, notified and warned the inhabitants of the town of Reading qualified to vote in town elections and town affairs to meet at the place and at the time specified by posted attested copies of the town meeting warrant in the following public places within the town of Reading: Precinct 1, Warren Killam School; Precinct 2, Reading Police Station; Precinct 3, Reading Municipal Light Department; Precinct 4, Joshua Eaton School. Precinct 5, Parker Middle School. Precinct 6, Barrows School. Precinct 7, Birch Meadow School. Precinct 8, Wood End School, and Town Hall. The date of the posting being not less than 14 days prior to September 12, 2016, the date set for town meeting in this warrant. I also caused a posting of this warrant to be posted on the Town of Reading website on August 23, 2016.
Thank you. Two quick announcements. As is our tradition, when we have instructional motions before us at the beginning of the meeting, I will read them. We won't get to them until later, but this gives you a chance to know what's coming up. In both cases, they may come up. One is, in the event the home rule petition outlined in Article 7 is enacted by the legislature, town meeting advises the Board of Selectmen at its earliest tax rate setting meeting after the enactment to implement a classification factor such as the cost of senior tax relief is borne 75% by the residential class, 25% by the CIP. The second is, ask town finance to begin researching tax policy that could assist Reading residents of all ages for whom property taxes might become an overwhelming burden. Again, we'll get to those a little later. Now, business under Article 1. Mr. Sexton moves that we lay the contents of Article 1 on the table. Is there a second? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 2. Mr. Sexton moves that we place the substance of Article 2 on the table. Is there a second? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. Business under Article 3, Mr. LaLash.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator, town meeting members. By charter, the first three articles are prescribed. Since this article was going to appear, we took an opportunity to work on it quite extensively. The first change is an essential change, and it's listed on the screen behind me. In FY17, the current year, we ask that $26,000 be added to the fire department capital. There's already a funding for an ambulance for $175,000. This issue was so urgent that FinCom has already given $26,000 of its reserve funds to the fire chief for this purpose, but he cannot lawfully spend it until the capital plan changes. So that's the only thing of this article that you're asked to do tonight that actually has immediate consequence. As you know, Article 3 otherwise does not fund any changes in the capital plan other than FinCom has done this. There is no other request in front of the body for any funding of any capital, but you'll thank me in November. We have a very long town meeting that this is all going to be put behind us. In FY18, we've moved 600 plus thousand of capital up or added to the plan. We've also at the same time removed about $600,000 of planned debt, not yet issued, not yet voted on, but at least it was in a prior capital plan, so that's about a wash. And then in FY17, depending on how our free cash is certified in October, we do have a $210,000 urgent request. FinCom did not have the funds to pay for a new $210,000 item, or we might have asked them. DPW has had to go out and spend $15,000 a month on a short-term lease for a piece of equipment that broke down that was not anticipated to do that. It was going to be replaced in the future. Behind the $210,000 is another $280,000 of capital that may be requested, again, depending on our finances. And in April, there's $120,000, again, depending on our finances, may be requested. I will expect to bring the $210,000 to November, regardless of the financial condition. The other items may be pushed into the FY18 and beyond if the finances of the town do not warrant it. I guess my only other comment is the capital plan is in excellent shape. It's balanced for the next 5 years, absent any changes. And in years 6 through 10, there's actually quite a bit of a surplus. You can't fully depend on that surplus because things change. But I will say, in working with all of our department heads, both on equipment and facilities, that our capital plan is in the best shape it's been in at least 10 or 12 years, which is excellent.
FinCom report, Mr. Burkhart.
At our meeting on August 31st, 2016, the Finance Committee voted to support the subject matter of this article by a vote 7-0-0.
Selectman Insminger.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At its meeting of September 6th, 2016, the Board of Selectmen voted 4-0 to support the subject matter of Article 4.
Any further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the motion under Article 3, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 4, Mr. Lillac.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Our town meeting, this is the first of four, what I will describe loosely as senior tax relief articles. Some of these the body has seen in past years. This is one of them. This first article increases a tax exemption. So a tax exemption means you never have to pay the tax. There's other language I'll use later in the evening about deferred taxes. Currently, Reading is at $750. Until this summer, the state maximum was $1,000, which we propose to change it to under some legislation. That number may go up. Surrounding communities are at $1,000. One of them's at $500, actually. They're cheapskate. One or two are at $750, but the majority have gone to $1,000. This body in 2010 was asked to go up from $500 to $750, which was at the time the average of our neighbors. Now we're simply asking again to move up again the average of our neighbors. This affects 20 seniors currently, and the number has generally been between 18 and 25 in the last 10 years. So it's small, but it's an important thing for them. You can see some of the eligibility guidelines shown behind us. This is, again, a state program under 59, Section 541C, administered by the Board of Assessors. So this will very clearly be lost tax revenue to the town if you approve it of about $5,000, much as it was 5 years ago when we last asked, 6 years.
Board of Assessors report, Mr. Crook.
The Board of Assessors at their meeting of August 30th voted 2-0-0 to recommend this article.
And FinCom report, Mr. Lydeck.
At our meeting on August 31st, the Finance Committee voted to support the subject matter of this article 7-0 with no abstention.
Blackman's report, Mr.
U.S. Moderator, at its meeting of September 6, 2016, the Board of Selectmen voted 4-0 to support the subject matter of Article 4. It affects a few number of people, but it's an important first step in our multifaceted senior relief agenda for the evening.
Further discussion? Appearing. We ready for the... Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Coco.
Richard Coco, Precinct 4. I'd like to make a motion to amend this to $2,000 per senior.
That's
20
not,
seniors
that's
qualify.
Not, that, just so you know, that's not legal by state law.
So what is legal?
Can we do 1,500 now? Not have been passed. 1,000 right now is the maximum. It's quite possible in 6 months from now there's a bill that's been filed that could increase it. I think I saw 1,500. So right now 1,000 is the maximum.
The maximum by the allowed by the state?
Yes.
So the town cannot on its own do different?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Further discussion? We're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion. Business under Article 4, Mr. Lillac.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Article 5.
This is even a smaller housekeeping issue, if you will. This ties the previous article to a cost of living benchmark. Cost of living doesn't change much, so instead of being $1,000, it would be $1,002 a year from now. But generally speaking, philosophically, it's a good idea to tie things to indexes so the town meeting doesn't have to keep addressing this problem. And again, to the extent you see the last item was $5,000, you know, this is a $50 a year kind of thing. It's not a big thing. But again, it may prevent the body from needing to take this up every few years.
Board of Assessors report. Mr. Crook.
The Board of Assessors at their meeting of August 30th voted 2-0-0 to recommend this article.
FinCom report, Ms. Landry.
our meeting on August 31st, 2016, the Finance Committee voted to support the subject matter of this article by a vote of 7-0-0.
Selectman report.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At the Selectmen's meeting of September 6, 2016, the board voted 4-0 to support the subject matter of Article 5, indexing the previously indicated senior exemption. Seems to make a great deal of sense.
Mr. Lalesh.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. If I may add, this is a method where you can go above the $1,000 limit. I know Wakefield, for instance, has. Okay. We'll see what happens, but you know, the indexing this is the only way to get around the cap, right?
Further discussion? Yes. Ms. Sasso?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Sasso, Precinct 2. Just a quick question. So this is the CPI tied to the exemption amount, meaning to the $1,000. Is it possible to tie it to the annual, the income limits as well, or is that a not allowed by the law as well?
Hi, I'm Victor Santanello, the chief appraiser for the town of Reading. The indexing actually affects the income and asset limitation. You saw on the previous slide, income for a single elderly person is only $20,000. 30,000.
Right.
This will begin to slowly increase in the hope that more people will qualify for exemption because those amounts are so low. That's why we only.
I'm sorry. So this article also impacts that, or is that already being done?
This article specifically impacts the income and asset limits on the elderly exemption and the amount of the exemption for surviving spouses.
Okay, that's the question. I wasn't entirely clear. I apologize. Oh, thank you.
Further discussion? Yes.
April Northrup, Precinct 6. In Article 5, when it says increasing the amount of the exemption granted to senior citizens, surviving spouses, and surviving minors, are the surviving spouses and the surviving minors, are they subject to the same now $1,000 tax exemption, or is it a different amount?
Sadly, surviving spouses and minors only receive the max amount of the exemption is $175. That amount can be raised by...
Can we increase that amount from $175?
I'm unaware of any provisions under state law that address that.
So if we wanted to attempt to do it and see if the Commonwealth allows us, we could, or?
It would be a home rule petition because it's a statutory exemption as outlined by state.
It just seems to me what's come up before at other listening sessions was talking about people on low incomes who may not be senior citizens and that it would be difficult to figure out exactly who those people were and all the paperwork. However, if we're already giving an exemption to surviving spouses and surviving minors, we should already have those people identified, and it would seem in the interest of fairness that we should increase the exemption for them as well. I'm new to town meeting, so point of order, may I make a motion to do that?
You've just effectively given us an instruction under Article 2 to take it into consideration for a future town meeting.
Okay. I think
that's a good idea. But as Victor said, the only way we could accomplish that is through a home rule petition that I'm aware of.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing. We're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Business under Article 6, Mr. Lalesh.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Right now, no one is enrolled in this program. There has been between 0 and 3 seniors in the past. This is... Again, if seniors meet certain income limits. There's no asset test on this one. Seniors may defer their property taxes. Currently, they defer property taxes at an 8% rate of interest. This article proposes to change that as of when the article becomes effective. It's July 1st of this next summer, to 4%. So again, where no one's enrolled right now, it's not a bad time to do it. There's nothing going on. But generally speaking, the 8% seems almost usurious at this point, with interest rates being where they are, and 4% is a lot more than the town is earning on any assets. It should also be pointed out that upon the senior moving out or upon death, the state interest rate of 16% takes over, and that's not something the town has any say over. So this is merely the interest on the taxes that are deferred, and they could be deferred for a number of years as long as the senior qualifies. And again, this is a test that the Board of Assessors apply.
Assessor's report, Mr. Crook.
The Board of Assessors at their August 30th meeting voted 2-0-0 to recommend this article.
FinCom report, Mr. Mall.
Our meeting on August 31st, the Finance Committee voted to support the subject matter of this article by 7.
And Selectman, Mr.
Moderator, at our September 6th, 2016 meeting, Board of Selectmen voted 4-0 to support the subject matter, Article 6.
Further discussion? Elisha? Oh, okay. Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. Bob, do we have any control over the $40,000, or is that locked in too?
That's state law.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Tom Grant, Precinct 4. Your point on the 8% rate being almost usurious is well taken. Given the current level of interest rates and the unknown direction of interest rates in the future, might it be wise to make the rate that we charge a premium to a certain base rate, so that we don't have to consider future rate fluctuations in the future?
I looked at that, and I don't believe that's legal, because the state does have a floor. 4% is a minimum, so anything you'd peg to an interest rate could be less than 4, and that would not be legal. I suppose you could say something plus 4.
You knew what I was going to say.
Yeah.
was that discussion taken up, or will this be a similar
situation? It was taken up in my head. The state makes it very clear that 4% is a minimum that anyone can charge. So to index something so you wouldn't have to come back, you would have to assure a 4 of a floor, which pretty much means you have to have something plus 4, which gets you back into 6 or 8 at least. It didn't seem like there was a point.
I just think if part of the rationale for doing this is comparing the rate to what the town earns on cash balances, there may come a time in the future where the rates again are so different we'd have to change this again.
Yeah, your point's well taken, and I think if that time comes, we'll be back in front of town meeting. There could be applicants that are doing this. We could make a different decision. I'd rely on the Board of Assessors to make that call and request it of town meeting.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Doctor?
Nancy Doctor, Precinct 1. My question was somewhat connected to this last speaker. I didn't know if there's a time limit on this article so it can be reviewed really for that very same reason, such as, you know, a reassessment in 3 years or?
There's no reason it can't come back for at least after three years.
Okay, thank you.
So yes, the body could consider it again.
Further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 7. Mr. LaLasha?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I haven't timed myself, but if I might ask for more than 10 minutes in case I need it.
Is there any objection? None appearing? Continue.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The three articles that have preceded this one, the town meeting has approved. have a very meaningful but a very limited audience in town, and we're certainly grateful for that. There are both medical and financial challenges that our seniors face, as many of you are aware who either know them or are them, as I am. Aging in place is not an easy thing to do in modern society. Medically, that's a whole different issue. There's nothing this body can do about that. Financially, there's very limited things this body can do about it. But one thing that the body does have some control over is the impact of property taxes and, to a lesser degree, water and sewer bills. What this article is a home rule petition, the third one of its kind in the state, drawing a little bit on the two that have preceded it, in order to present an opportunity for the seniors to age in place and avoid at least the issue of being priced out of their homes because of property taxes. Seniors represent the fastest growing segment of our community. This body has debated and approved some zoning bylaws, for instance, and you'll see some more in the future. The best example is the by right in-law apartment, for instance, to prepare for this increased demographic, quite frankly. I always like to point out that, because I've been accused of not saying this in one meeting, in addition to being morally the right reason, the elderly are cheaper than students, and that's factually true from town government, just to be clear. State law, we found, after looking at this for over 18 months, did not provide the town any tools at all, above the three you just saw, to protect the seniors in the community against property tax increases. This article, as I said, will follow behind Sudbury and Whalen as the third one that, if it's approved, has done so. There was an opportunity for this tax policy to be designed so the town would forego income, as it did in one of the previous articles. One of the two other communities has done that. I don't remember if it's Sudbury or Whalen. Clearly, Reading is in no position to forego tax income. So the goal here, we talked from numbers all the way up to $1.5 million down to $1 million or so, and the Selectmen, through extensive discussion over the summer, culminating about a month ago, wanted to make sure that $1 million was a cap, but a $500,000 to $700,000 range was a reasonable target to, if you will, shift taxes away from seniors that might qualify to all other taxpayers. And to be clear, when I say all other taxpayers, just to put it out there that state law by default would allow the town to do something like this and only have the rest of the residential property class pay the $500,000 or $700,000 shifted. Through tax policy, the Board of Selectmen has a right to shift then some of that cost onto the commercial, industrial, personal property. That's already been mentioned as a possible instructional motion, and that's fine. It cannot be part of this article because that is a separate tax policy purely under the control of the Board of Selectmen, and the state would reject any effort to do that within this legislation, just to be clear. One thing we discussed at the class level, at the staff level, and then brought it to the Selectmen is, for the 20 residents that apply and qualify for the other senior tax relief, for 20 people it's not a large burden of work, but if there were a few hundred or several hundred applicants to do the same amount of background checking on assets and income, would require more staffing without any doubt. And this is not something we could go to a temp agency for seasonally. This would be a full-time person, a very confidential employee, because they'd be seeing a lot of information about you and some of your neighbors that should be protected by the town. So one of the things we wanted to attempt to accomplish, I always like to call it, is ease of administration. Let's make it as simple as possible. We don't have to hire anyone. We want to be able to do it simply. We want you to understand it very simply. So that was at least our first objective in any kind of tax policy, is let's take a crack at that. So the proposed eligibility criteria is really, really simple for us, a little more on the state level to be discussed. The applicant has filed and received a prior year Schedule CB, otherwise known as circuit breaker, state income relief, tax relief benefit. So if in the prior tax year, if this was active right now, in August the Board of Assessors would have had an application period, and a senior, in order to be eligible, the first hurdle was, did the state allow you to qualify for senior tax relief under Schedule CB? And we'll come back to that. Once the Board of Assessors is satisfied and you can prove that that has happened, The board then wants to see that you've owned real estate property in Reading for the last 10 consecutive years. Now, to be clear, we discussed this, but the selectmen decided it was not necessary that the senior own the exact same property that they're applying for tax relief. They may have downsized, but that they should own property for 10 years. And in fact, the Board of Selectmen inquired of our appraiser, Victor, how about 15 or 20 years? Because the goal of this tax relief more so is to protect those seniors that have been in town a long time. And Victor advised us that tax policy 10 was a maximum, that there was no law about that, but there are other programs where 10 is a maximum. And through informal discussions, I'll say with the state sort of whispered 10 years would be a real good idea for Reading to do. Finally, and again, quite simply, the third qualification is the applicant must apply annually to the Board of Assessors. So in terms of understanding the policy, I think this is fairly simple. In terms of administering the policy, it's also very simple. We have to see that the state has approved you to participate in the program. We have to look up and make sure you've owned property for 10 years, and you have to come see us every year. It really doesn't get a lot simpler than that. In terms of proposed tax benefits, this is where it starts getting to be a little bit uncertain, I guess I'll say. We have no idea who's going to qualify for this program, and I'm going to circle back to that. So the selectmen decided on what I would describe as a fairly wide range of possible tax benefits, between 50% and 200% of the income tax benefit. Right now, if you filed for Schedule CB, I think the maximum was $1,070 or thereabouts for the last tax year. So $1,070 would have been your income tax relief. What this 50% to 200% allows the selectmen is to cut that in half, so $500 and some, or double it, $2,000 and some. So depending on how large the pool of applicants is, the individual's tax relief may vary between $500 and $2,000. The advantage of having the 50 to 200% clearly from the Board of Selectmen standpoint is, right now we have no data. We don't know what this is going to look like. This gives the board some latitude in targeting a number. I would say in the future that, generally speaking, home rules petitions such as this have been approved for a maximum of 3 years. So we've written this up to be a 3-year. If town meeting approves this and the legislature approves it and the governor signs it, 2 years from now we'll be working on a renewal and we'll have data at that point, and then we can decide whether 50 to 200% is appropriate or whether it's too wide, frankly. Here's what the state requires to be eligible for this Schedule CB. This is as of 2014. Age 65 or older, must file as single, married, filing jointly, or head of household. No one else qualifies, that's it. If you're a homeowner, you must have an assessed value, and this is an indexed figure, so as of 2014, a maximum of 691. So I forget the figures, but in Reading, the average home is about $500,000. This will knock off 20 to 25% of the homes that are worth more than $691,000. One might say the people that own those homes may not need this relief, possibly. The income qualifications as a maximum, and this gets to be something you really need to stop and understand, from $56,000 single all the way to $84,000 married, filing jointly. I think, as I did, many people, when they look at that number, they say, wow, that's a lot. And it is in a way. However, if you're looking at your mass AGI, your adjusted gross income, and that's where you stopped, those numbers would be very high. Those are not the numbers to compare. You need to add back in Social Security. You need to add back in any other untaxed retirement income, of which there are significant amounts. And you lose some exclusions to your mass income taxes. So by no means is this a one-to-one. It's not even close for a correlation between your mass-adjusted gross income and these figures. It is significantly different, and it varies quite a lot by person. The tax credit in 2014 was a maximum of $1,050. And the last thing, which is really important that we don't have to administer but the state does, is they make you prove that more than 10% of a combination of your real estate tax bill plus 50% of your water sewer bill exceeds that income. So again, look at the income, maximum of $84,000 married, filing jointly as adjusted, as I mentioned. You must therefore pay $8,400 in combined real estate taxes plus half your water sewer bill. The objective of Schedule CB as an income tax benefit is for those who are being priced versus their income very high in real estate property tax plus water sewer charges. That is exactly what the town had as an objective when we set out a couple years ago to try to find some tax relief, is the folks who are most impacted by the property taxes that they're paying relative to the income that they have. I'll tell you what we know, which is not much. In 2014, 645 residents qualified for income tax relief. The average income tax benefit was $856. I don't have any idea what the distribution below 1,000 was. We don't know how many of the 645 were renters, and therefore they wouldn't be eligible even to begin with because they don't own property. We don't know of those that own property how many have lived in town and owned property for 10 or more years. But just to be careful in the other direction, we don't know if there is anyone, and there wouldn't really be any logical reason for this, but it's possible you could be eligible for Schedule CB and not have applied for it. And you might be eligible, therefore, under property tax relief. So we just don't know. What we do know, which is in your warrant report, is that the 645 residents times that 856 was about $550,000. So some of the analysis that was in the warrant report suggested if all 645 were eligible, and if the selectmen set 125% between 50 and 200, then you got a figure of about $700,000. From Sudbury and Whalen's example, and we have no idea if we'll be similar or different, about half of those that were eligible for state income tax relief were eligible for property tax relief. If that's true in Reading, the number is 300 and something. I think it's really important to emphasize there may be imperfections in this program. None of us in this room, neither the appraisers nor the Board of Assessors nor myself, has good data. We know 645 and we know $856. We don't know anything else. Well, we know about the 20 seniors that qualified under the first three articles. What we'd really like to do is have a 2 or 3 year test drive period of gathering data under this program. To the extent the town meeting may not be comfortable about some of this, the Board of Selectmen have capped how much tax relief may happen. And I think it will unquestionably, unless the state legislation, come back before this body in 2 years with facts, with a proposal to renew this. One of the two communities asked the state this summer or last spring to renew it in perpetuity, and they would not. They gave them another 3 years. So we're certain that this is not the end of the line for this home rule petition. We will need to be back in front of the body again in 2 years or so. Again, the selectmen have said that they're targeting a maximum benefit of about $1,300 and an average benefit of about $1,000 for those that qualify, with a total at what works out right now to be 125% in that range of about $700,000. As I mentioned, the selectmen through tax classification and tax policy that they have authority to do, and they do in every November, have the ability to shift this away from the residential class onto the commercial, industrial, personal property. The figures behind me, and I apologize, one of the tables had it backwards. We were not asking people with lower assessed valued houses to pay more. That would be interesting. I just had labeled it wrong. These are the figures at 700,000. So what the selectmen discussed all summer, as they always do, is worst case, and I think the number was $115 for an average home. That would be $1 million. You can see here $81 is the more reasonable targeted level, if you will, for the average $500,000 home. And that 70% of the homes would pay between $50 and $80 for this legislation. And 70% of the businesses would pay between $60 and $150 for this legislation. And you can see some of the commercial properties, especially in Walkersburg, would pay a good deal more. That's all I have. Thank you.
Board of Assessors report. Mr. Crook.
The Board of Assessors at their meeting of August 30th voted 2-0-0 to recommend this article.
Income report, Mr. McNeese.
At our meeting on August 31st, 2016, the Finance Committee voted to recommend this article by a vote of 7-0-0.
Selectman's report, Mr. Ensmeyer.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At our September 6, 2016 meeting, the Board of Selectmen voted 4-0 to support the subject matter of Article 7.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mario. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. As one who has filed for the CB and been rewarded by it for the last several years, I think this is a good move. When I looked at my proposed tax bill for 2018, it'll be $5,302, and 125% relief will help me very well on that one. I think after I pay you back the $50 from the lower end of the thing, I'll probably come out around $1,250 to my relief. If you consider my piece of property is probably a valuable piece of property right now as far as resale. My house will be knocked down, I know that for sure, and probably $1 million house put on there with four children. So I think the question is, do you want to keep me there for $1,200 or do you want four children?
That's a tough call.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Doctor.
Nancy Doctor, Precinct 1. I agree with Mr. Brown that this is a really good start. In fact, I think it was a wonderful plan for Sudbury. I just don't think it's a good plan for Reading, and I'll tell you why. I don't think Reading compares to Sudbury in a lot of ways. Their tax rate is actually the highest in Massachusetts. It's 17.81 compared to ours. So when they actually presented this to their town, it was actually really easy to say to the taxpayers in Sudbury, this is just an extra $50 on your average tax bill, which was close to $12,000 compared to our average tax bill. I actually think this is a good start. I do think that comparing Reading to Sudbury and Wayland, two very affluent communities with assessed home values much higher than Reading and basically medium income, isn't really actually appropriate. My concern is the seniors that actually will not qualify for this, and the concern is if we're asking for an override for some of the seniors that will not be affected by this, what's the extra burden on them? So I'm happy that we're actually looking at our senior population, but I'm not sure I can support this bill.
Mr. Centennial?
Just to your point, we didn't base our community comparisons on both Wayland and Sudbury. Out of 351 cities and towns, those happen to be the only two communities that have this special form of tax relief. So what we did was review both extensively. I talked to my peers in those communities and tried to find the best fit for Reading with the the wishes of the Board of Selectmen and Town Manager to try to figure out something that, you know, would be Reading-centric and compatible to our population given our valuations and taxes.
Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. I would like to make an amendment, if I could. And right there, how many homeowners have not been so, not perhaps right there, but the 10 years, I'd like to reduce that to 5.
Where are you, where is that exactly?
Well, in the warrant that we got, it's in section one, D.
Okay. We
section
have
2D. I'm sorry.
All right. We have it
section
up on the
2D.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion?
Mr. Second. Moderator, if I could I put
yes.
two numbers in one motion?
What is the? I'd rather treat them as two separate ones.
The other one would be section two. B, if that's still in play, because Bob did not mention that. It says, if the last line on B up above, if the joint applicant is 60 years of age or older, is that still in play? Because you didn't mention that.
Yes, it's still in play, but it's a separate motion.
Okay, so to change that would be another motion?
Yes.
We can't do it together? Okay. All right, so stay with the first one then on
okay.
D.
Is there a second to that? Second, Mr. Nadario?
All right, I mean, when you look at it, 10 consecutive years before filing in any domicile in Reading. The reason I suggest that we go to five is because with the condominiums, you find that there are senior citizens that are maybe moving into Reading from nearby towns and buying a condo. They could possibly qualify for this exemption. To ask them to be here for 10 years is kind of a push. So I think 10 years, personally, I just think it's a long time. I know it's going to add to our individual tax rate, but I think the way people move today, I think five is plenty, and I would just urge us to do this as one way of including a few more people. Thank you.
Okay, discussion now on the proposed amendment. Is there further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, Mr. Arena.
John Arena, Precinct 1. Mr. Daddario, the board talked about that very point. And the motivation here is to protect seniors that are already in Reading and who are, by virtue of income or circumstance, want to age in place. What lowering that number has the unintended consequence of doing is creating a, if you will, an attractive place for those outside the town to move in. Our goal was not necessarily to motivate those who aren't presently Reading citizens, but rather to find a balance between the statute and providing some amount of coverage for those seniors already in the town. You could make an argument to even perhaps make this larger. We're talking about people that might have been in the town 20, 30 years. If it were set to zero by way of extreme example, you'd potentially have people moving in the town to achieve this benefit, and that's not our goal. Reducing it from zero to one, two, or three, you're just diminishing that effect. 10 has the effect of being a balance between providing a reasonable window for people to demonstrate their residency and yet providing a criteria that we can all measure very easily. Thank you.
Further discussion on the amendment. Ms. Binda.
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. I also think that I agree with the idea of allowing seniors to age in place and allowing a tax break for low-income seniors. I have a few questions, though, and a few comments. I was a little surprised at the number of what the numbers of what is considered low income, and also
right now we're discussing the proposed amendment. The from 10 to 5. I'll get back to you.
Okay, sorry.
Further discussion. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Not appearing. Is it one? No. Oh, I'm sorry. Down the end.
Precinct 5. I just wanted to rise in support of the amendment. I think it's reasonable, and the fact that the home rule petition would expire within 3 years, I think would counteract the incentive for people to move from out of town because they wouldn't know if it was going to last beyond 3 years. So, and they would have to go 2 years beyond the expiration. And I think it's reasonable and it is inclusive of more individuals. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. O'Neill.
John O'Neill, Precinct 4. And the subject matter is very near dear to my heart since I've worked for the last 42 years in the field of aging. However, I'm actually opposed to this amendment. I think it would be a different story for many of the reasons that Mr. Arena, you know, stated. If it would be a different story if most of the communities in the Commonwealth had such an act. Here what we would be doing is, in fact, help subsidizing people from other communities, you know, who it would be an, it could very well be an incentive for some people. It may make just enough of a difference for people to be incentivized. And I don't think that that's necessarily a good thing. I think the circuit breaker and what is being proposed, and we'll talk about that when the appropriate time, but I think the 10 years seems to strike a balance, a fairness, and particularly since we're talking, I think the people who have been, say, suffering, but many of the elders who have been here for many years and have supported, you know, the schools and, you know, previous overrides, I think they've done their bit, and I think they should be rewarded, and those should be the target group until we know more. If, in fact, you know, the situation changes, we could always, we have to revisit it anyway in a couple of years, we could look at it again. Thank you.
First, Mr. Mon, then I'll come back to you. Mr. Mon.
Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I'm in support of that change to 5 years because I'm a senior, and I think Reading is a great town, and I think it's a great town for seniors to live in. And I find it very difficult to believe that a senior in another town would sell their house, pay $10,000-$20,000 in realtor's fee to move to Reading to wait 5 years to save $1,000. That just doesn't seem logical. I think we should encourage, make Reading a great town for seniors, and encourage seniors to live here. So I'm in favor of the 5 instead of 10 years.
Mr. Berman?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. We spent a lot of time sort of trying to pick the right number and trying to figure out who is it that we really want to try to assist. And we came upon 10 years sort of as a compromise. There were those who wanted to actually, myself included, maybe make it a little bit longer. If you look at the reason why folks are having a hard time staying in their homes, it's not that they're not earning any income. It's just that the value of their house has outpaced their ability to pay for those taxes. I'm sure, Mr. Brown, when your family built that house years ago, and Mr. O'Neill, when you bought your house years ago, you didn't expect that the appraised value would ever approach $600,000-$700,000. That was just an unheard of kind of thing. But unfortunately, or fortunately, that's what happened. For a lot of us, our wealth is in our real estate. It's in our property. So it's really, we designed the program for those people who came in and maybe spent $30,000 for their house or $150,000 for their house, and their taxes were modest, but now, through no fault of their own, they can't pay their taxes only because the value of their property has gone up. So if we decrease the amount of time that you need to be here to 5 years, those people who bought a house here 5 years ago paid, not as much as what the house is worth today, but almost as what they're, 5 years ago the real estate market was hot, and they paid a pretty price for their house, and they would argue that their taxes were higher. The folks that we were trying to target were those folks that, you know, paid a little bit of money, and the property taxes were a very small percentage of their income, but now, because of rising real estate, they're priced out of their house, not because they want to leave, but because they can't afford to stay. So that's why we wanted to kind of keep it at the compromise was a 10-year. I do see the point of trying to make Reading attractive to seniors to live in, but really our goal was to make Reading attractive and have the ability for people to stay here who have been here and help build this town over the years. So that's why I would urge you to vote no on the amendment.
Further discussion? Ms. Cooper?
Yeah, Kendra Cooper, Precinct 8. There are a couple thoughts I have on this issue. I think I'm supportive of reducing it to 5 for several reasons, though I hadn't really thought about it until I came here and listened to the discussion. For one thing, if you look at the federal weatherization grants and oil assistance and everything, they look at renters as well. And it's interesting to me that that's not included here, but they do look if someone is renting, and they are qualified. So that's something we might think about, but not in this particular this situation. But I think that unless you're aware of that, you may not understand that rent, that a lot of elderly don't own property but rent, and they've lived in the community for a long time. As far as something else that I don't think people are thinking of is, 10 years ago, Massachusetts passed something called the Equal Choice Bill, and that was incentive to allow people to stay in their homes, and if they qualified because of income, not to be able to, if they qualified for the state to pay for them to be in nursing homes, then the state would pay for them to have at-home care to encourage them to be able to stay in their homes. And that's something that a lot of times people don't know about, but they should be able to. And Reading is a classic place. We have a situation just recently where an elderly woman died, was able to stay in her home for 5 years and even 2 years afterwards with the state paying for her to have care in her home. The larger picture outside of Reading taxpayers and Reading school systems and everything is that when you look at the state, when we don't keep people in their homes, then the state is paying far greater for that person to be in nursing homes. So, I mean, on the one hand, we're looking right at Reading, but the larger picture that affects us directly, just as, say, our water bills affect us directly since we just got them, water and sewer's gone up. And, you know, all of these are costs for the elder. And I look at this, and just before I came here, and I came late today, because I got a call from someone else in Precinct 8 who explained to me that she understands how elders feel and how elders really need this, but she said, we also have a problem, and I believe at this financial forum I heard someone raise the question or raise the point about college costs. And there are people here who are struggling. There are people here who have lost their jobs, and they are trying to make do. They're not 60 and over. They're people who really need help, and I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking that perhaps we should be considering a lot of other aspects. I think it's a good step here for us to be looking at this, and I think 5 years, think about where you were 5 years ago. What did you know about your finances? Did you lose a job? Were you in danger of losing a job? We were, when my sons were in college and high school, my husband was on the verge of being let go for 2 years. It's no fun living that way. So I think that we need to consider a lot of these aspects, and we also have to look back. 5 years seems to be a pretty consistent number, both at the state level and the federal level, to look back and see what someone's income was or look back and see how the people were doing. So I believe, as I'm explaining to you, I believe I'm more in favor of this 5 years as opposed to 10. And I don't think, as a previous speaker had said, and he had raised the point that, you know, people, elders are not going to sell their homes unless there's a family member already in the Reading area or in the Reading district. There are many people who are staying here because they have children and grandchildren here. So I think that people are not going to be moving in droves. That kind of thing happened when special ed was passed in the 1970s. People were moving over the border from New Hampshire to Massachusetts, Newburyport, Salisbury, that whole area. And the state of Massachusetts ran into some serious problems then. But I don't think that's going to happen with elderly. So I would urge you to consider this change.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, on the aisle.
Mary Ann Downing, 13 Heather Drive. I support Mr. Berman and Mr. Arena, and I'm opposed to changing this to 5 years. And I want to point out, in case we forget, there are seniors who have, or possibly people close to seniors who have bought here recently that are going to get caught, are going to benefit from the three-year term of this. Consider Reading Woods, which is 50% over 55. As Mr. Ensminger pointed out at the financial forum, we're getting like $2 million potentially when that's fully built out in property taxes. So take half of that and 10% away, and I don't know if you're losing $250,000 in revenue if they're all over 65, but there's a significant potential of older citizens who have moved to this town in the past few years that are going to potentially benefit in these 3 years. And so I do not support changing this to 5 years. Thank you.
I saw another hand over here. Yes.
Jennifer Hillary, Precinct 7. So is my understanding correct that the practical result of this amendment, a motion for an amendment, is that there will be a greater pool of people who share the same piece of the pie if the Board of Selectmen have put a cap on the amount of money that will be allocated to this?
Mr. Lasher?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Yes, I think that's a fair point, that the Selectmen have again, within the total absence of data, have said 700,000 sounds like a good number. So this just spreads out that 700,000 among more people, those that have moved in within a less amount of time.
Thank you.
Mr. Lasher, did you have a hand up? No. Okay. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. D'Addario?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I support this amendment. I mean, for people, seniors who might be moving in, most of them are going to be paying top dollar, as previous town meeting members have suggested, and most of them are not going to be eligible for this in any way. If you're moving into Johnson Woods, I have a feeling you're not going to qualify for this particular benefit. I do point out, too, just to emphasize that we never know where people are, and you don't know what individual circumstances have transpired in any family. And so to allow more people into this, I think, is a good thing. As I said, for personal situations, which we can't possibly foresee. The other thing, in closing, I want to say, it is no disrespect to our selectmen. It is no disrespect to the hard work that they put in, and as well as our town manager, when they come up with an article, if we at town meeting disagree. It's not, you have 5, 6, 7 people doing their absolute best to come up with an article and to come up with numbers. And the numbers are many times arbitrary. With a lot of hard work, they have to come up with a number. Town meeting, we've got maybe 193-2 people, and there's a collective wisdom here, and it's okay to change things. That's why we're here. And when you hear, as most of you, even I might have originated the amendment, but I heard so many interesting takes on it. I didn't never thought of myself, but by hearing other people talk about it. So if you think 5 is right, and we're going to do it for 3 years, it sounds like a way to be more inclusive. More inclusive. If you're going to err slightly on the side of generosity. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes, Mr. Struble.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jeff Struble, Precinct 7. This is about the ideas that have been raised by the amendment, but it might divert us into a new direction. The intention, I believe, of putting a term on qualifying the 10 consecutive years or 5 consecutive years, whatever we decide, is that intended to be for the property which is being requested to be relieved?
Mr. Lalasha.
No.
So
you can downsize.
Right. So if you lived here, essentially it's your track record. You know, if you lived here 20 years, sell it, buy a condo, your 20 years is qualifies you for this.
Correct.
I don't many of them all. That's it. That's fine. Great.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Okay, Mr. Russell.
Jack Russell, Precinct 3. I hope that the intent of this whole article is to maintain, help the elderly, which I'm a good example of. Not that I'd qualify for this, but was to keep them in their homes that they've had in Reading for a long period of time. It's not to attract older people to come into the town. I think that the 10 was too low, and if this amendment is defeated, I'd be happy to offer an amendment to raise it to 15.
Are there further town meeting members that would like to speak on this? I know we have one non-town meeting member. Yes.
Jeffrey Corum, Precinct 7. I agree with that, Mr. Daddario's goal to, you know, increase the applicability of the thing, but I think Ms. Hillary has the correct point that this is then possibly diluting the effect of this relief that we're trying to offer to these longer-term residents, that they might not see any meaningful relief at all if it's spread out over too many people. So I'm against the proposed amendment.
Further discussion? None appearing. We had... Is one over here? No. We had somebody from the back? Yes. Could you use the microphone, please? And just state your name.
My name is Charlene McLean. I've been here 20 years. And I just wanted to make the comment that I think it's a nice thing that the town is doing with this. I think if we look at what's going on in the whole Northeast region, it's a boom town. And people are moving around like no tomorrow. And there's a lot of wealth coming in from other parts of the country to move into the Northeast region, probably because we have such great schools and we protect our children. I think that that with the amount of quick and rapid change that's going on throughout the state and a lot of money changing hands, it's very important for towns that are attractive and have a good level of quality to maintain the continuity of the constituency of the town itself, and making it affordable for long-term residents who are probably more aware of what's going on in the town and have a particular continuity of a kind of point of view and understanding of what the town is about over a long period of time has a lot of value for the people coming in there's a reason why the people are attracted to the town, and I think it's the body politic of the town or the constituency which reflects a certain point of view or attitude about how life should be in this area. And that's a great value, I think, for anyone who comes to this town and for the people in the town. It would be a sad thing to see people sort of be pushed out or kind of dismissed. I know that... a long time ago, I met a man who was probably, you know, 30 years ago, who was he was a wealthy resident of Weston, and in Weston, they put in senior housing that made it so that people who'd lived there, who maybe had aged out and their income was no longer what it was, were able to stay there in the town and not be pushed out. You know, I think in the general situation that has gone on over many years is, you know, there's a lot less support for people in positions of need, economic need, where, You know, you don't want your seniors or your small children even or your teenage children to be made to feel like if they're not in place or scheduled somewhere, that they're somehow vagrants that should be pushed on down the road.
Right near the end of your time, can you just wrap up? Oh, you're all set? Okay. Further discussion? Okay, we'll take a vote on the proposed amendment. A yes vote lowers the number from 10 to 5. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Mrs. Binder?
Sorry about that. Angela Binder, Precinct 5. I too applaud the selectmen and the town for coming up with ways to aid seniors and keeping them in town and opportunities for them to age in town. I have a few questions though and a few concerns. One of the questions is, this talks about a primary domicile. So if an elderly who qualified this had another property in Florida or on the Cape, would that be considered as either an asset or count into it? Do you count secondary properties?
Well, they would need to qualify for the. They would need to qualify for the state circuit breaker.
Okay.
So if assets exceed any limitations in the circuit breaker income tax, then they wouldn't be able to qualify.
So, what is our thing? It seems to be just income, but that would include assets too, like a second home. That would be part of it for.
For the circuit breaker, I don't think there's an asset test.
Okay,
so
it's an income test, not really an asset test. Okay, so that's one concern. That is there another answer to that? Okay,
Mr. Lasher,
if I might, the Board of Assessors by statute have a right that they perhaps rarely exercise, that they can deny any senior tax relief based on assets. So regardless of how this home rule petition is worded or the prior three articles were worded, they have the right to see, aha, a senior with $1 million of assets and you know, several homes, we're gonna deny this for you, so you know.
Would you be able to know that, or would that be reported to you? Because if they're only reporting income, would you actually have a way of knowing whether there were additional assets?
I'd probably trip them up with a question on the application. Do you own another home? But if any applicant falls beyond the intended scope of the spirit of this home rule petition, then the Board of Assessors would deny them.
Okay, but again, my concern is just whether or not you would have the information to know that. That was just something when I was reading in here about. It talks about principal residence. So if that was something, when I attended a meeting and first thought about this, I was really very much in favor of this. But then I heard younger people talking who were objecting to it, younger families. And everybody wants to give seniors tax relief, but it's borne by other people. And some of us might be able to bear that, and other people might not be able to bear that. I know that there are only two other towns, Sudbury and Wayland, and that you didn't choose them as peer communities, but those are the only two towns that currently have something like this. And I looked some things up, and right now, the latest available data is that Reading has a per capita income of $46,000. $209. It's a per capita income in Reading. Our average tax bill is $68.24. And this is what I got from Mass Muni books, if it's a little off. Wayland's per capita income is $144,000, $144,135, and Reading's is $46,000. Sudbury's per capita income is $98,133. Wayland's average tax bill is $12,000. Sudbury's average tax bill is $11,598. And I get this information at the Wakefield Library because ours is closed right now, so just to throw them in. Wakefield's per capita income, you know, neighboring town, is $38,782, and their average tax bill is $5,600. So the per capita income of Wayland is over three times Reading's per capita income. However, their average tax bill is only 1.7 times Reading's real estate tax bill. So Reading residents already pay a higher percentage of their income on property taxes. And we did hear people talking at a meeting about, you know, who is gonna bear this? Like, everybody wants to give seniors tax relief, but it is borne by some people. And there were younger people talking who said they don't have equity built up in their home. And if their taxes rise significantly, they will be bearing it too. And even renters, you know, you say, well, maybe really low-income people in Reading aren't going to be, you know, they're not paying property taxes, but the people from whom they rent will be paying property taxes, and their rent will go up because of that. There are only two towns right now in Massachusetts that allow this, and they do have different financial situations. And I also, just talking to other people about it too, I think it was told to me that, and I don't know if this is true, but that those towns have fewer opportunities for residents to maybe downsize. And you know, I know people want to stay in their home, but maybe people also, residents also just want to stay in Reading, not necessarily in their home, but maybe they want to downsize. And I think Reading's created more opportunities. And I don't know that that's the case with Sudbury and with Wayland. So I think that the towns have different circumstances, and I just think that that needs to be considered. And also, we don't know how the burden would be split, whether it would be split by commercial or the and residential. I know that it's been discussed, but that doesn't come up till November. There could be other circumstances. I mean, there's no guarantee that that's going to happen. I would have liked to have seen that come up before this come up. So I really support this in theory, but because of all of those reasons and the phone calls that I've gotten, people I've talked to, I'm not gonna be able to support this. Thank you.
Mr. Lelager.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just to reiterate one point and make one other. Those two communities were picked because they're the only ones that do it.
Right.
That's where the comparisons stop as far as we're concerned. We chose some of the math, one of them used, some of the math, another one of them used, and ignored them entirely otherwise. So it's a Reading model. So whatever their objectives are, we don't know and we don't care. Ours are different, just to be clear. The other thing, just because it's something I've done in the background and it's tricky, per capita income is a very tricky measure. As you probably know, Reading has a lot of students. Many of them have no income. So per capita, our income is X. But our household income, which is where you pay your property taxes from, is quite higher. It's 110 or 115,000 right now. And Wakefield, although the library's open, that date is old.
Oh, yeah. It's from the Mass Municipal right. Association, the latest that they have published.
But just to compare Reading and Stoneham, because I remember those, Stoneham has just under 11% per capita students, and Reading has 17% students. That changes the amount of people per household and the calculation of household income quite a bit, just to be fair. And I don't have any idea what Sudbury and Wayland have for students.
So you should ask Mass Muni to put all that information back in that booklet, because they used to have all of that, and it's really, they don't publish it.
Further discussion? Mr. Ensminger, then I'll come back to Mr. Russell. Mr. Ensminger?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Thank you, Angela, for bringing up the point about classification. The board did take a stab at that, in that, as Town Manager pointed out, in order to grant this tax relief, we do have to do a certain amount of shifting of the total tax levy that is not being paid by that group. The board did take this up at a recent meeting and agreed in principle that we cannot bind a future Board of Selectmen, that when this comes up for a classification vote, if this current board were to be voting at that point in time, and this will be not till December of 2017 for FY18 that we're talking about, same year as the override would be effective if it passes, we voted a residential factor of 1.02. So what that effectively would do is give an equal tax rate to both the residents and commercial. But it would, without having done that, if we kept a factor of one, residential tax rate would be actually slightly higher than commercial because of the shifting we have to do. So we have taken that up. We cannot vote in a binding way to do that, but the board is on record as saying they're favorable to that sort of approach.
Mr. Russell.
Jack Russell, Precinct 3. As promised, I'd like to make an amendment to Section 2, Paragraph D, changing the 10 consecutive years to 15 consecutive years.
Is there a second? Second. Mr. Russell, you all set? Further discussion on the proposed amendment, raising that number from 10 to 15. Yes, sir, in the middle.
George Visa, Precinct 2, new town member, so forgive me if I'm wrong. I believe the 10-year is a state limit. Is that correct?
Mr. Santaniello?
10 years is the max under any given existing statutory exemption program in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Raising it to 15 would be inconsistent with existing regulations governing other statutory exemptions, and in my estimation will present a high hurdle of passage to the legislature.
So let me get this straight. Is it legal to try it? It's just that the idea maybe it may not pass. Mr. LaLasha?
Victor has to work with the DOR. I don't. The DOR is not going to like it. It's not that it's illegal. There's no such thing dealing with the state as black and white. They have discouraged us strongly from going more than 10 years. That was the initial indication the Board of Selectmen was for a higher number, and the DOR, through Victor, strongly discouraged us not to go higher than 10 years. Who knows what that means? If you've granted Selectmen leeway, and this is probably a question for Town Council, if Beacon Hill suggests 10 is the right number and we've put 15, does the language in this article allow the Selectmen to make that change?
Mr. Meares?
Town Council says that would. We've put a clause at the beginning that does allow the Selectmen to address any concerns that Beacon Hill may have, not any concerns, but within the four corners of the article.
Okay. Further discussion. Mr. Mon?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jimmy Mon, Precinct 4. And I just have a question. But before I ask the question, I think that the target and the goal of making this as simple as possible is a great goal, and avoiding the need for more administration is also a great achievement. So you've listed three very simple, straightforward criteria to be eligible, yet I thought I heard that the appraiser could deny one of these even if they meet the three eligibility criteria.
Mr. LaLasher?
Just to be clear, it's the Board of Assessors, not the appraiser. And that's true of any tax policy by default, no matter anything that you or I or this body says or does. That is state law. They have that right to do that. I think it's very rarely exercised, if ever, in Reading, but they do have the right to judge the intent of a program and the facts that they see in front of them and make a judgment.
And is their decision, can their decision be appealed, and if so, to whom?
You could appeal a final decision of the Board of Assessors to the Massachusetts Appellate Tax Board.
And then just one final question. Once you're deemed eligible based on these three criteria, as long as it isn't overridden, then is the amount to each eligible person the same, or does it vary from one person to another person?
It can vary based on the amount you received as a circuit breaker credit.
So then the person that decides that amount will see the applicant's income tax return?
We will see the Schedule CB from your income tax return and perhaps ask some questions about it. We may ask for a copy. I haven't fully decided on what type of application process. I'd like to make it pretty easy yet comprehensive.
Thank you.
Okay, remember we're talking about the proposed amendment from 10 to 15. Any further discussion on the proposed amendment? Not appearing. Are we ready for the vote? A yes vote would change the number from 10 to 15. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. And those opposed, the motion does not carry. Mr. D'Addario, you had a proposed amendment too, right?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I think hopefully this amendment will not be as controversial. On B, right above, looking right at the screen, the last line, it says, if the joint applicant is 60 years or of age or older. In other words, if there are two applicants, one has to be 65 or above, and the other 60 years or of age or older. As we know in Massachusetts, I think we can see the trend that many older women are marrying younger men. I think most people will agree with me. Unfortunately, I'm not one. But my point is that it's quite possible that a man or woman, 65, might have a spouse, a mate, that could be 58 or whatever. I know my brother, there's a 10-year difference between himself.
Before we continue, this may not be possible, but what is exactly the amendment you propose?
Is that possible, Bob? Can we reduce to 60?
Our understanding is that this is state law set by Schedule CB. We cannot change it.
Wow. All right, thank you.
You may want to have that discussion with our three elected representatives in Beacon Hill.
All right, we're back to the main motion again. Let's see, over here first, and then we have another one over there.
Hi, I'm Matt Annunziata, Precinct 8. I just had more of a clarification. You had kind of breezed through the presentation, but you had mentioned that you'd have to hire another employee. Do you have any numbers on that? Because, you know, if we go to the cap that's 700,000 and say it's, you know, 50, 60 grand to hire someone plus benefits and all that stuff, you know, now you're talking closer to 100 grand. So that's, you know, 14-15% more than what we're actually talking about.
Mr. Lalashin.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. 50-60,000 is probably a reasonable salary range, and then you add 20-25% benefits, so you're up to 80,000. But just keep in mind, all the numbers we're talking about in this article are moving tax revenues around. This adds a whole new cost that doesn't otherwise exist, just to be clear. So regardless of what percent it is, this is an $80,000 cost the town does not have currently, and this program will not produce any revenue to pay for it.
Yep, okay, I guess that was my point. Thanks.
Okay, and there was another hand, right? Yes. Yes.
Kevin Breer, Precinct 3. My question really is, if we don't pass this, has there been any modeling done in terms of what the net inflows and outflows will be on the town? Will we be in a surplus position? Noting that this is revenue neutral.
Mr. Lash.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Perhaps I should have, I think in the language, in the written description I did, but perhaps I should have said up front that the reason we're here in September is for this article. In order to have it possibly be effective by July 1st, when an override could potentially also be effective. You know, had we chose to wait until even November town meeting, there was a chance that a home rule petition could get enacted by July 1st, but no guarantee, whereas right now we have a guarantee as long as we're agreeable to the terms. So the important thing from that standpoint was timing, next July 1st. It is completely tax revenue neutral. From a income or revenue standpoint, the town has no opinion whatsoever. You know, there will not be more or less dollars flowing into the town next July 1st. There is potentially a longer-term consequence about who you're attracting to town and who you're, if you will, pushing out of town in costs. That does not affect revenues.
Has there been any modeling on that, though, the attrition and then new people coming in?
Only by the cemetery department under Mr. Brown. No, I've never heard of anyone doing modeling like that. It's an interesting idea. It's difficult for me to imagine people moving to a town because of a tax benefit like this, but I suppose anything's possible. Whereas it's quite possible, and we unfortunately do run into people from time to time that for $1,000 do have to move out of town.
Further question? No? Okay, over here.
Paula Perry, Precinct 1. Bob, I did just want to clarify now that I thought we didn't need to hire someone because we're adopting Circuit Breaker. So I just want to clarify that.
Mr. LaLasher.
Yes, if the policy is passed as proposed, we do not need to hire a person. If we stray from the state Circuit Breaker and you ask our assessors to make judgments based on income and assets, for instance, then we would need to hire someone. As proposed, there is no additional cost to the town. Thanks, Paula.
Mr. O'Neill.
John O'Neill, Precinct 4. This appeals to me both as far as my social consciousness as well as my practical side. On the social consciousness side, I think there are many older people. There are people of all ages struggling, but there are less opportunities for things to change for the older people as far as their income. It is what it is in most cases, and given the fact that the interest rates are so low, it's great when you're buying something, not so great when you're depending on fixed income, you know, as your revenue source. On the practical side, I would hope, since I strongly support, you know, the override, that maybe this might mean that some older people, this might make the difference between them willing to support something that's not going to be, that they could see as an immediate benefit, though I do think it benefits the whole town, but that's for later the discussion, I guess. So I definitely am supportive of this proposal. Thank you.
There's a hand right behind. Okay, people that haven't talked yet over here.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. That's Tom Grant from Precinct 4. I just want to address the idea of inclusiveness and fairness, which some other folks have already brought up. I was in support of the previous articles related to elder assistance. Article 4 made our exemption in line with other towns. That seems fair. Article 5 adjusted it so it would move with the cost of living. That seems fair and reasonable. Article 6 made the interest rate more in line with market rates. That also seems to make sense to me. This article does not seem fair or inclusive. It certainly helps low-income elders, but it does not help the folks in town who are living paycheck to paycheck, who are certainly much harder to identify without something as simple as a circuit breaker. With regards to staying in your home, I can understand elders want to age in place and how that can actually be beneficial, but I also again think about lower income families, again living paycheck to paycheck. They might actually have to move. That would, I think, be not beneficial to the children in the town and in that family. In this article particularly, I think it's a blunt instrument. It doesn't, as I said, address inclusiveness everywhere, and also the range is quite wide. I understand that the Board of Selectmen has an idea in place for what they'd like to see, and it's going to depend on how the numbers come out, but were we to approve this, we'd be giving the Board of Selectmen, I assume you're the ones making the decision, quite a broad range of directions to go, as a town meeting member, that seems potentially too broad to me, just the way it's written. one other point I wanted to make, Mr. Berman, you made the point about the assessed values rising. According to Zillow.com, the market value of homes in Reading has risen 25% over the past 5 years. I dare say that's faster than the assessed value, so a senior in their home would probably have the option of monetizing that asset in many ways, and probably more so than the assessed value has risen. Finally, I would like to thank some other folks for making a very personal comments about why they are in support of this. Just for me personally, the assessed value of my residence is less than $691,000. I lost my job in December. My AGI is going to be less than $84,000. I'm not going to get a benefit from this. In fact, my real estate taxes will go up. And I have four wonderful kids, who I think the town benefits from having in town. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Sylvester.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Paul Sylvester, Precinct 3. I have a question about this, in that we have said this is revenue neutral for the town and the town budget, but it is not revenue neutral for the taxpayers. And they're also looking at the other elephant in the room, which is the override. And we're looking at numbers that are approaching a $1,000 increase on the average home. So the question I have is, this proposed legislation deals with a tax exemption. What is the possibility of converting this to a tax deferral, where we have already lowered the interest rate, and you know, perhaps putting some limits on that based upon assessed value or equity in the home or whatever, in order to allow our seniors to do that? Because we know that in many cases, without the appropriate protection, when those seniors have to leave Reading, and if they end up in an assisted living facility or some other place, that neither the state nor that facility would hesitate in the least to try and make use of that asset. In our case, at least, we would be lending against it. The town certainly would have a good standing in order to be able to leverage its tax hold on the property. And we would be able to give seniors the relief, in a sense, from their current payments, maybe be able to be up at the maximum end more often. And it would not only be revenue neutral for the town, it would be revenue neutral for the taxpayers. And that would give them a little more room to perhaps support some of the other things that we wish to add in the budget.
Mr. Olasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I would guess, first of all, that such a change would be outside the scope of this article.
That is true.
It's an interesting second thought, perhaps. But just to follow up on that, let's pretend that that's what was in front of us in some way. Tax deferral is not tax avoidance. So no one else is allowed to pay for your deferral. That is a loss of revenue for a period of time to the town. You know, maybe it's tolerable, maybe it isn't. But the state would absolutely not let someone else pay your share of what you didn't pay this year if you need to pay it in the future, just to be real clear on that. And we can't force people to want to participate in a tax deferral program, certainly. To the extent that there's poor data on this, I don't know even how you would estimate what the lost revenue could be for some periods of time on that. But it's certainly an interesting point, though, but not for this article.
Further discussion, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. Like I said, this will benefit me approximately $1,250. So the next year that I apply for the CB, that is deducted from that. So now I have a lower threshold to get the CB, so that might work against me. I don't know yet. And the other thing, too, is not only the tax relief, it's other things. Will I buy a gallon of paint to paint my house, or do I buy food? In many cases, that's a situation that people are facing. If I don't paint my house, it goes down in value. All my neighbors suffer from that and all the other things. And the town suffers because my value goes down. Yours goes up to make up the difference. So that's another point I don't think many people know.
Is there a hand up on the aisle? Yes.
Lori Briere, Precinct 3. I just want to ask a question. When you talk about the cost of senior care, what exactly are you including in that?
Mr. LaLesha.
I'm not sure what you're asking. Like, what
when
do you,
you
mean?
When you, I know it's been brought up comparing the cost of, you know, bringing in more students or keeping the elderly in place. What is considered, you know, included in the cost of elderly? Are you considering
their
passing care, like if they're in a Reading Cemetery?
It's a real simple question. You look at the town's budget, look at the human elder services component, and then compare that to the school budget. So per elder, we have a figure. I don't remember what it is. It's less than $100 per elder, I think.
Right,
and
but
per
I think
student, we're around $10,000, or give or take. So it was not meant to be an in-depth discussion, just an observation that in terms of town funds, very little town funds are spent on elders in the community relative to students. It has nothing to do with...
No, I agree that students are more money, but I do think that if people, you know, do, if they just... There is a small population, I agree, that should be left, but I think that this opens a lot of loopholes for different people to try and get the tax exemption, whereas, you know, maybe if there's incentive for people who may want to sell and move, you know, downsize within Reading, because we do have that large Reading Woods 55 plus community, then we have, you know, new families coming in. But, you know, even though the elderly services, I know what you're talking about, they're wonderful, I'd have to say. My grandmother's involved in them. But also when, you know, if these people want to be lifelong members of Reading, I think something people should consider is the cemetery cost and how, you know, that's going up and there's, you know, proposals for that. So, you know, the care continues a little bit after.
Further discussion? Yes, over here, Ms. Russell.
Peg Russell, Precinct 3. My question concerns the process for extending it. You mentioned in the background information that Sudbury had gone to the state for a temporary extension, for a permanent extension, was denied, received a temporary. What would be the process that would be followed at the end of the 3 years? Would you be coming back to town meeting? Would the selectmen simply go to the AG, or what?
Mr. LaLesha.
I guess first the answer would have to be to determine why did the state disallow it. And we don't have any facts, but we have some stories, some opinions. I will say that I'm having breakfast with 9 area town managers and mayors this week. 6 of them are looking at this. This is not something that's unique to Reading. Our reps and state senator are looking at this as possible statewide legislation. So there's been some talk, and it's pure speculation, that the state does not want to encourage anything past a certain period of time because the state may introduce some legislation. A home rule petition would be allowed to stand through that, most likely, and then state legislation would take over a program like this, if you will. You know, the risk that we thought about when we realized we can't ask for a permanent home rule petition is, what are the odds that the state says in 3 years, no, you can't do it anymore and there's no alternative? You're out of luck. We think the odds of that are very low, but they're not zero. As witness, you know, one of the towns getting another 3-year extension, they didn't say don't do it again. They just said we can only do this 3 years at a time. So honestly, Peg, it's speculation as to what might happen, but if we were sitting here 2 years from now, the selectmen would be engaged in a process to replace the home rule petition for sure. Much like they just went through, we'll have learned some things. We'll have 2 solid years of tax data, perhaps the 50% to 200% can be moved in a little bit because it is a little wide. we'll all know a lot more about what we've experienced, and we may learn some unintended consequences. You just don't know those things. But I would think the selectmen would go through another public process as they have this summer and come up with another solution for town meeting.
Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle of Precinct 3, I move the question.
Is there a second to that motion? This ends debate. It requires a two-thirds vote. Mr. Brown, would you take your side of the hall plus the Finance Committee? Mr. Crook, would you take my right center? Mr. Rushworth, would you take my left center? And Ms. Russell, would you take the left plus the Board of Selectmen? Again, this is a vote to end debate. All those in favor of ending debate, please rise. Thirty-three. And those opposed to ending debate.
Six.
Three.
Five. The vote being 123 in the affirmative and 26 in the negative, the question has been moved. We will now go direct to a vote. This requires a majority vote, but traditionally when we have a home rule petition, we do it by a standing count. So again, I would like to ask that you withstand. All those in favor of the main motion, please rise.
Twenty-six.
Twenty-nine.
36. And those opposed?
Two.
Nine.
Eight.
The vote being 120 in the affirmative and 29 in the negative, the motion carries. Before we do that, I have an announcement to make. Before proceeding, the chair offers an explanation of what will be happening with the substance of Article 8. As you all know, the purpose of the town meeting is to enact legislation and to approve the budget. Upon reading Article 8, I saw a problem. There was no call to action, no proposed motion, and there really could not be one. The decision on a proposed 2.5 override sits squarely with the citizenry as a whole and not with the legislative body. After a meeting with the chairman of the Board of Selectmen and the town manager, I came to understand their desire for transparency for town meeting on the updated financial condition of the town in the override election of October 2016. Next spring, town meeting will be voting on a budget that will be greatly shaped by the outcome of this override vote. At the same time, I explained my reservations from a purely technical standpoint on bringing this article to the floor of town meeting and the precedent it might set. This proposed Article 8 is more of a report to town meeting, such as is typically made earlier in the meeting, yet at the same time, it creates an obvious opportunity for two-way dialogue. Our reports at town meeting do not allow for such two-way discussion on the floor. There's no debate. My decision, which has the full support of the chairman of the selectmen and the town manager, is to call for an adjournment of this body without a formal discussion of Article 8. As a legislative body, town meeting has no formal role in the override, though it may have a great interest in the outcome. I will call for a motion to indefinitely postpone the substance of Article 8. Next, if this motion does not pass, we would deal with any instructional motions. We have two. And then I'll call for a motion to adjourn town meeting sine die if it has not already passed. After adjournment, I will turn the meeting over to John Halsey, the chairman of the Board of Selectmen. The Selectmen's meeting will continue in session, and the substance of Article 8 will be discussed as it was designed. I encourage those town meeting members who have an interest in the topic to remain, as I will, in order to facilitate the discussion. This approach will satisfy my technical concerns about town meeting and the Selectmen's desire for transparency. Now, we do have a motion to adjourn sine die. I will tell you, this that's non-debatable. We do have two instructional motions, but I will take your motion. Is there a second? Second. All right. All those in favor of adjourning sine die, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Business under Article 8. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay the substance of Article 8 on, indefinitely postpone. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor of indefinite postponement of Article 8, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 2. Mr. Berman? Mr. Berman, do you have a question?
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just trying to get the technology down here.
Okay, sorry. Mr. Coco, point of order? Do you have a point of order?
Yes.
Would you approach the microphone?
When I came to this town meeting, my understanding, at least my expectation, Richard Coco, Precinct 4, was not only to stand in age and place, I guess, the new wrinkle, but to vote and consider whether we want to put the 2.5 question on the ballot. In the past, my recollection, past town meetings, we have done that. For the library, we put the issue on the ballot through town meeting action. Why are suddenly we changing the way we do things?
Mr. LaLasha.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The town meeting has never, I repeat, never considered an override, ever. Debt exclusions, absolutely, because the town meeting must authorize debt. So for a debt exclusion for the high school, for the library, yes, absolutely. Town meeting has never been consulted. Has never even discussed an override before from all the research I did in the 20 years I've been affiliated with town meeting.
Well, I've been a town meeting member on and off since 1980. And my recollection is that when there was the override last, in the 80s, one time or another, that this body put the question on the ballot by voting here first.
Mr. LaLasha.
You wouldn't be following state law if that's what happened. Only the selectmen have that right.
Has the state law changed in the intervening years?
No, it has not. I know it has not.
Okay. Then this body is not being asked to render a judgment on this whole idea of raising taxes. Correct. With all discussion about having savings for elderly people, the savings for elderly people is not to raise taxes. That's the savings for elderly people. People on fixed income. I look around here, I don't see people on fixed income. I see a lot of people on fixed income. The interest rates are less than 2%, have been for 10 years almost. Retirement plans are not changing, but expenses keep rising. And the real estate expenses are rising faster than anywhere else. Thank you very much.
Okay, Mr. Berman.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 4, and a member of the Board of Selectmen. Before delving into the specifics of this instructional motion, I would just like to take a second and have this to sink in the historical implication of what we just passed. State law does not really allow local communities to tinker with tax policy. Essentially, we have evaluation, we set a factor, we send out the tax bills. That's essentially what we do. Yet you as a body a few minutes ago have just stood up for a vulnerable section of our population and boldly stated that as a community, Reading acknowledges and values the contributions longtime senior residents have made to the building of this town, and that we view as a critical piece of public policy that we in town do all that we can to keep seniors aging in place and not be priced out of the town that they helped build. We join with only two other towns in the Commonwealth, Sudbury and Wayland, to offer this assistance to lower-income seniors. Those towns, as mentioned before, perhaps maybe a little richer than we are, and maybe have more resources than we do. But we still value the richness of a generationally diverse community, and that we're a better town when we take care of all of our citizens. I want to acknowledge the work and commitment of my colleagues on the Board of Selectmen, especially Chairman Halsey, who raised this a number of times in meetings as we struggled with sort of figuring out the 2.5. It would have been easier to decide not to confuse voters in the middle of an operating override discussion and just not take this on at all. Our town manager, our town assessor, and our town council did yeoman work in researching and crafting this proposal, which we have learned is now being looked at by a slew of other towns as they struggle with the ability to keep seniors in town as real estate values soar above their ability to pay. We've bravely opened the door and taken a deep dive on tax policy. The home rule petition you have just passed, or to be submitted to the legislature, will subsidize low-income seniors up to $1 million a year. I know we used the figure of 700,000, but we talked to sort of the outside number up to $1 million. That $1 million is not foregone revenue, as was discussed. It's picked up by the rest of the taxpayers. What the home rule petition does not address, is what component of this subsidy will be paid by the various classes of property. That's what this instructional motion before you attempts to address. By law, any residential property tax relief to seniors would have been absorbed 100% by the residential class. In effect, this would have meant, Mr. Ensminger said, would have had residential taxpayers paying more than commercial, basically by a factor of about 25 cents per thousand. In an effort to equalize the tax rates and not have the residential class pay a higher tax rate than commercial, the selectmen gave forward advice that if the home rule petition passes, they would set a classification factor which divides the subsidy approximately along the percentages of assessed value of the classes of property. Since residential property equals approximately 92% of the value of all the property in town, the senior tax relief subsidy would be borne 92% by the residents and only 8% by the commercial sector. This, friend, strikes me as patently wrong. The argument to initiate this effort was made almost as a moral imperative. As a community, we'd be better when we can keep our seniors in town. It was argued by many it's the right thing to do. Tonight, many of you have underscored those sentiments. In my mind, when something is argued as a moral imperative, it implies that any sacrifice made be a shared one. If we're all made better, then we all need to contribute. What is before you now is a motion that advises the selectmen that when the legislature, and hopefully they do, when the time comes, you would like to see the burden of this tax relief spread to be more equally shared. What I propose is modest. Instead of a split of 92% residential and 8% commercial, this would move the needle a little bit. The tax relief would be paid 75% by the commercial, and 75% by the residential and 25% by the commercial. And here's the impact of the proposal on the various classes of properties. Here are some of the observations. So what I've broken down here is what the cost of the senior tax relief would be. This does not include the override, but just the senior tax relief spread out over the various classes of property, and what we think that this will add to the tax bills based on the differentiation of values. So what you have here on the first row is what would be the increase in residential and various breakdowns of value at 92% and at 75%. And then further down, what the additions would be along the commercial sectors. So what you can see is that there really isn't much of a savings to homeowners. Rather, this is an effort to push the cost of relief onto those with more of an ability to pay. The whole notion of senior tax relief is to shift some of the burden of taxation away from those with less ability to pay. It's totally appropriate then to place the cost on those in a better position to pay. During the listening sessions on the override, one of the most prevalent comments brought up was a wish to, people said that they wish they were able to tax the larger commercial properties in town a bigger share. We don't have the regulatory authority to do so other than shifting the factor. You can see that the overwhelming burden of the senior tax relief will be paid by those properties in the $1 million to $10 million range. Seventy-1% of our commercial properties, the ones that house more of our traditional mom-and-pop small businesses, will see increases, but these will be more modest. I do acknowledge the value of our small business in town. They play a vital role in the fabric of our community. Those properties assessed under $1 million will pay a little bit more. However, I would argue that our small business in town will probably be the main beneficiaries of senior tax relief.
Mr. Berman, you're right at your time limit.
Okay,
can you wrap it up?
Two more minutes.
Is there any objection in taking two more minutes? Okay, continue.
They will be the main beneficiaries of senior tax relief other than the seniors themselves. Every economics textbook and common sense tells you that when people with lower incomes receive additional money, they don't invest in the stock market and they don't put it in the bank. They spend it. And it's not a reach to assume that the elderly will probably spend those dollars closer to home. Some have argued that increasing the tax, even modestly, on small business will have a chilling effect on attracting new businesses and keeping current businesses viable. One piece of information we learned when we brought in Professor Barry Bluestone from Northeastern for our economic development self-assessment is that property tax rates have a negligible impact on location decisions for business. They look at markets, they look at workforce, cost of energy, proximity to transportation, and ease of working with town government. I would argue that Reading rates A-plus in the first four factors, and we're getting better on the last one. Looking at tax rates of towns that border Reading, that look and feel a whole lot like us, you can see that all of these towns have a higher commercial tax rate than we do. Certainly, their small businesses are under the same pressures and constraints as ours. Tonight, we accomplished something we should be very proud of. It's also something we should all be willing to support financially, not mostly on just the one class of property owners. The setting of tax rates, classification factors, and senior exemption factors all fall under the purview of the Selectmen. It's something we annually do in November. However, since we have opened the door on tax policy and taken a huge step in altering the status quo, as one of your Selectmen, I would value your guidance and advice as we navigate those complicated issues and strive to make Reading the best town we can for all of our citizens. Thank you. I encourage you to pass this instructional motion.
Is there a second to that? Second. Further discussion? Point of order? It's instructional. That's exactly what it is. It's not binding. It's an instructional motion. Mr. Ensminger.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. As I indicated earlier, this did come up at a previous Selectmen's meeting. We spent the better part of an hour and a half kicking around what we should do about the senior subsidy regarding classification in the future. And all those same arguments were presented to the board. I believe it was a 3-1 vote that evening. The chair had been there, it would have been a 4-1 vote in favor of splitting it equitably along the lines of the assessed value. I will say, having been through a number of classification hearings, there are a lot of complexities involved. The facts on the ground change every year. That's why the state requires us to take it up every year. So Perhaps my colleague should sharpen the focus of his arguments with his fellow board members and try to win it over that way. I'm a little uncomfortable with him going to another body to kind of tell us how to behave better.
Further discussion, Mr. Arena.
First of all, thank you, John Arena, Precinct 1. Thank you all for sticking around this part of the meeting and what's to come. This is probably the most difficult decision we make, or one of the most difficult decisions we make, is the what's so-called split between the residential portion of the levy and so-called CIP, commercial, industrial, personal. Simple numbers. If you say the entire levy is about $60 million, it's not, but say it's about 60, 8% of that, or about $4.8 million, is the CIP portion. The balance, about 55 and change, is the residential. The motion we made earlier will raise the residential. If we say it's a $700,000 exclusion, it's the ratio of 700,000 to 54 million, or about 1.4% increase in the tax rate for the residential portion. Mr. Berman's absolutely right. The commercial portion has not moved. It's at its old value, 1.5% lower than a moment ago. The Board of Selectmen voted to reestablish parity. What was parity before at 1-to-1, to reestablish it by gently nudging up the CIP split by 2%, which reestablishes commercial at almost the same level, as close as we can make it, as the new residential. The proposal on the screen suggests to alter it further, such that commercial, although it's taking 25% of the increase, it only represents 8% of the levy. 25 is bigger than 8 by a factor of over 3, so it's going to be paying 3 times the rate of the residential. I'm not a genius. I'd have no idea how we treat Home Depot the same as we might treat a Pamplemousse or a Zynga. If you deal with a small business, the cost of real estate taxes is right on the P&L. It comes right off the owner's income statement, and it's probably one of their largest single expenses. If you talk about a Home Depot, they're drawing customers from all over the Northeast, and they're in a much better position to deal with the variations in taxes from town to town. We have no such levers that distinguish between a small business and an enormous multinational global entity. And for that reason, I've chosen to simply leave it as parity. We've chosen to nudge up the residential rate, we nudge up the commercial rate, so again, we're about even playing field. Once we deviate from that, we've done exactly what Mr. Berman said moments ago we didn't want to do, which is tinker with tax policy. Doing this is tinkering with tax policy. I personally am not smart enough to figure out the right number. But what I know is from day one, we've had a parity rate. I frankly do not care a whit what goes on in Wakefield or Stoneham or Saugus. I only care about those members that elected me in this town. If you'd feel differently, speak up. But we've always had a parity rate, and largely to increase and support the smaller businesses for whom real estate taxes are a direct burden on their P&Ls. If you feel differently, please speak up. But we have, frankly, a very blunt instrument to deal with this. And once we deviate thinking that it'll burden the larger businesses, it burdens the smaller businesses disproportionately. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Russell? Mr. Graham, excuse me.
How soon you forget, Mr. Moderator. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Russ Graham, Precinct 4. I think Mr. Berman is about to take us down a very slippery slope. If you heard me at home, sometimes when the Board of Selectmen meander into areas which are not their domain, I make some interesting comments. Sometimes it's zoning and other areas. It is not their domain, it is town meeting's domain. This is the Board of Selectmen's domain, and it's a very slippery slope to decide that if you do not prevail with your board, you'll come to this body to begin to get some discussion or comment on what is not our domain. It is the Board of Selectmen. I would urge us to vote this down for no other reason than to discourage that action. Thank you, Mr. Munger.
Further discussion? There's a hand over here. Oh, Ms. Snyder.
Do
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. Maybe it's getting a little late and I'm feeling a little irritated, but we seem to compare ourselves to other communities whenever it suits us to compare ourselves to other communities, but when we don't like it, we say we don't care what the other communities are doing. So I just had to say that.
Mr. D'Addario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I have to give Mr. Berman a bit of praise because I know I've heard him stand up and kind of push this in other settings. So I give him praise because it's not easy to do, especially when you think of the small businesses and the fact that many of us know them personally, so it's a hard thing to do. But I do support what he's saying, and I think in most towns, I don't have the statistics at all, but I think most towns do have a separate rate for businesses than they do for residential properties. And I think Reading has held to parity for a long time, but I think we haven't. Many new businesses have come into town. I don't claim to know what the split should be, but I do think that his instructional motion is at least worth considering. And I think as business gets stronger in Reading, and I hope they do, that that tax rate does need to be split, mainly because in general, the commercial side can support a higher tax rate than the average resident. Thank you, Mr. Berman.
Further discussion? Mr. Mon.
Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. As one of the selectmen said, this is one of the hardest decisions they have to make. Having said that, I don't understand why they are so resistant to bringing that hard decision before this body and getting some input. Seems to me that Mr. Berman has the right idea for a hard decision to open it up to discussion. So thank you for doing that.
Further discussion? Ms. Binda.
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. I'd like to thank Mr. Berman for bringing this up too. We're talking about taxes and burden, and there are some people who have said that senior tax relief would be a burden for them. Right now, I believe we have a valuation system, an income approach for valuing commercial property taxes, and my understanding conversation with a town employee is about leasing and rental. So there is, for valuation, there are, for that valuation system, I'm under the impression that that takes into income and expenses. So if a business is having their value, that is how their valuation is determined, unlike property owners whose valuation is determined by the market value. So if a business is having a hard time, they have deductibles, they have other ways of measuring of their valuation. If a homeowner loses a job, they still have to pay their taxes. So I think that this is a good way to consider that and taking other things into consideration. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. The Town of Reading Home Rule Charter is very clear on the distinction of who does what. It is not town meeting's purview to get into the tax problem. Our job is to vote on the amount of money, regardless of whether it comes from the industrial, the residential, or how it comes to this body, period. If you want to do instructional motions, I can think of a lot. I could tell the selectmen where I'd like them to go sometimes, but I don't think they go. No, I have a great deal of respect for them. But it is not this body's job to interfere with the executive body's job. Our job is to legislate and to deal with the money that we have on the table, no matter how much money it may be.
Further discussion? Yes, on the edge.
Marianne Downing, Precinct 3, and I understand this is not part of all the formalities, but
I think Mr. Berman is trying to have the Board of Selectmen understand, hear a lot of community perspectives as they take this into account. And I think that there's a lot more support for his motion in the community than they realize. I know not only do I support it beyond the senior tax relief, you know, move it on to everything else. If I recall from the meeting on September 1st here, please correct me if my number's wrong, did you say 40% of our commercial revenue that comes in is represented by Walker's Brook and General Way? So of that 8% of whatever that, you know, $8 million or whatever the valuation is, that close to half of it is the big business anyway. So I feel like that's a lot of, they're still gonna get the bulk of the burden. Do I have that number right? It was from the town manager's slides.
It is a big number, I'll find it.
So my point is that this is, I feel like even though, yes, some of the small businesses would get a bit of a burden, not only would extending this in the senior tax relief help the lower income people who aren't seniors in this town, if we were to move this towards the overall tax rate, I mean, we're in an override situation now. The difference we could get by increasing the taxes on that 40%, even if it burdens the lower, that could stretch out this override, that could reduce the amount. I don't even know why it's not on the table, quite honestly. And I agree with Mr. Berman's points that our neighboring towns, yes, we're Reading, and what our other towns do might be different, but the reasons why businesses are closing in Reading and leaving, I don't think it's due to our tax burden. I mean, Melrose is flourishing, Andover is flourishing, they all have split tax rates. So as much as this is not the proper way to introduce it, I think if it's the point of letting the selectmen know how different people feel, Mr. Berman, you've done your job and I support it. Thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing? Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the instructional motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the chair is in doubt. Do I still have all my counters? I do. Okay, all those in favor, please rise.
Fifteen.
19.
19.
26.
26. 26. Those opposed?
Six.
Six.
23.
23.
Six.
Six.
18.
18. Vote being 86 in the affirmative and 53 in the negative, the motion carries. Second instructional motion, Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. This is an easy one, and I mean it. No, I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding. To ask town finance to begin researching tax policy that could assist Reading residents of all ages for whom property taxes might become an overwhelming burden.
Is there a second? Second. Mr. Daddario.
Okay, this is, you know, years ago when we were raising taxes, there were times when I heard from this body a request to town manager and the selectmen, was there any way we could reduce taxes to the seniors or to those in need? And the answer always came back, there was nothing we could do, our hands were tied. And to the selectmen's credit and the town manager's credit, they found a way with that two other communities had already blazed the trail for us, so we were able to at least get help for our seniors. Now, there was a young man who kind of eloquently expressed that he might not, he certainly didn't look over 65, at least to my eyes, and that he had a family and he had a rather difficult situation with his four kids. So this instructional article is just that. It's an instructional article. It doesn't have any power. But I think it just asks our finance, our finance, what is he, manager? to at least look at future possibilities. What can we do to help people who are at least temporarily in need to prevent them possibly from having to move? It seems that, you know, economically, it could be that things might get worse before things get better in general. So staying ahead of the curve might not be a bad idea. And it certainly would be to Reading's great credit if we were the first to do this, and then others might be following us. I hope you would consider this this instructional motion, and I hope you'll vote for it. Thank you so much.
Further discussion? None appearing. Ready for the vote? Oh, was there just, yes, I'm sorry.
Hi, thank you, moderator. Linda Snow Doxer, Precinct 1. I'd just like to say that I like the idea of this instructional motion. I just also realize the discussions that we've had about night government and the number of hours that our town administration has put into this research. And I just would like to say this is an additional thing that might be very worthwhile, but it might take time because there's only so many people and so many hours and so much that can be accomplished. I like very much the idea of this, but it's not easy on the staff thing that we have, that I see how hard people are working already, but I think it's a good idea.
Further discussion? None appearing. We're ready for the vote. All those in favor of the instructional motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Okay, Mr. Halsey. We have a motion to adjourn sine die. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned sine die. Mr. Halsey.
Now, I would ask all of you, the Board of Selectmen are still in session, and we would like to continue. And my remarks are going to be extremely. We're calling the Board of Selectmen back from our recess to continue our board meeting. For those of you that are leaving, okay, and the school committee has come back to order. For those of you that are leaving, you'll be missing the information that we're trying to transmit to all of you as part of the town meeting. And I think that although it is, has been pointed out earlier, the business of the selectmen to both set a special election, decide to make the topic of that special election, a 2.5 override, and to set the amount. Those are all things that the selectmen are empowered and suggested to do when that comes up. However, it was our very strong feeling that this body deserved a courtesy call from us as to why we came to that conclusion. Research told us that in past override discussions, there had never been any explanation to town meeting as to how and where and why the selectmen had come to the conclusion they had come to. So we felt that it would be extremely valuable to present that. In discussing this with the town moderator and the town manager, we all did clearly agree that it was correct and appropriate to adjourn the town meeting in favor of a continuation of this information. You're here. I realize that the hour is late. This is probably carried on a little longer than some folks could stay awake for, frankly. But at this point, what we're going to do is move forward with the town manager and our superintendent of schools to give you the information that I think is important for you to understand as town meeting members as to how we came to the conclusion that, number one, consider a Proposition 2.5 override. Number two, take that to the next level of setting a special election for such a 2.5 override. And then number three, in working with the school committee and the town manager to come up with what we felt was a number that made some sense going forward to correct certain things like structural deficit and to take care of certain services that have been left untouched. So two things I'm going to do from here. One is to close my remarks. Next, to turn this over to both the town manager and the superintendent of schools for a discussion with you of how we got where we are. And we're going to open that to public comment and questions. And in order to do that, since many of you have stayed here in a setting that looks like a town meeting, I've asked the town moderator I'm going to surrender the chair momentarily for him to facilitate questions and answers and discussions from the position that he's in right now. So this is all a little bit unusual, but not unprecedented, not illegal. So we're going to proceed from there. So Bob.
Thank you, John. Look at that. Wow. If I might, including for those that are just leaving because I'm standing up, by a show of hands, who was here on September 1st? Okay, that'll help the speed at which I go. Since last annual town meeting, the slide behind me shows the selectmen of the school committee have had 21 combined public meetings on this topic. I think that's important to know. As Mr. Arena correctly mentioned, our property taxes are about $60 million. I'm going to give you two quick references. One is to a time before the last override, and one is to a time just after the last override. This goes back to before the last override in FY03. Since then, our largest growth in revenues has been property taxes, 4.6%. Part of the reason that's above 2.5% is always the last override of $4.5 million. And the other part of it is new growth. What pales in comparison, and frankly the reason we're here, is that 1.1% state aid. That has crawled along for many, many years. And if state aid, as you can see at the chart below, if state aid had only risen to 2.5% over this period, we would have $3 million annually more today as we stand here. We also have a couple of interesting revenues. We earn interest rate earnings. And we also saw some decline in federal payments. They represented another $1 million in lost revenue. So both state aid and local and other sources have not kept up at all. Property taxes have to pay. This is a comparison to after the last override. So there's no override between FY17 and FY06 figures. And yet it still shows, again, no override. Property taxes have increased from 67% of our revenues to 72% of our revenues. And again, they can only go up 2.5% a year plus new growth. That, as well as anything else I could show you, shows you that we have no other revenues coming into this town that really help, that grow at even 2.5%. Those of you in town meeting know this one, so we have a budget model that starts with revenues, takes away accommodated costs, and divides up the rest. Those who have been in town meeting for a number of years know the chart behind me. Revenue growth has been in the 2.5% to 3% area. That's where it's forecast, no surprise in the future. The big difference is accommodated costs. Town staff and elected officials have worked very hard to keep accommodated costs down. We've run out of tools. We just don't know what else to do. The forecast going forward is for accommodated costs to be significantly higher than they have been over the last few years, and that causes an annual budget gap. Right now, if we don't use any free cash in the budget, we would have to cut operating budgets significantly for next year. I should also add some of those things in the right-hand column. Have been warning signs, and that's the reason town meeting has been cautioned for the last 4 or 5 years. Using free cash to balance budgets, cutting capital spending, and still having layoffs and still having not level funded budgets have obviously been a warning sign. Last budget that this body approved in April was a use of $2.15 million in free cash to balance. Thus, it was out of balance. We're spending more than we are taking in revenue. we're using savings. As we sit here today, that number looks to have grown to $3 million, and I'll explain a little bit why. Right now, if we were to attempt to pass an FY18 budget, we would need $3 million of free cash just to hit the service levels we are now, and I dare say we couldn't really quite preserve those. So the current structural deficit is approximately $2 million on the school side and $1 million on the town side. Perhaps even more importantly is that graph behind me shows the structural deficit is projected to grow from now on. It didn't grow in the last few years by much because we kept accommodated costs at bay. You can't even see the difference between the revenues and the operating budget. There are two colors that are on the same line at the bottom. It's that red line, the accommodated costs that are forecast to grow, and add another $700,000 a year to that $3 million structural deficit. I think the body well knows what an override is, but just to be sure that I say the right thing, it seeks to permanently increase your taxes. The two people who would have objected have left, I see. In 8 years, at $700,000 a year, we expect to see that structural deficit to grow by another $5.6 million to a total of $8.6 million. An override by state law is a lump sum. If an override could be a percentage, that would solve our problem immediately. We would need a $3 million override to fix the structural deficit today, and then an increment to pay that $700,000 each year. We don't have that as tax policy. We have to pass a number that'll last for some period of time. So this is just a visual of a $6 million override would force the town in some way, and we'll describe that, to save money in the early years in order to spend it in the later years. But certainly a caution of this is, if that's really what you do, you've created an enormous deficit at the end, another structural deficit at the end of the 8 years, and we want to be careful about that. We can change our capital spending in the direction of those arrows to sort of lever the thing down so that we don't really save money. We spend it early on, and we don't need to spend it later on because we've got less capital that we need to spend. So the moral of this story is, I mentioned earlier the capital plan's in really good shape. It's balanced for 5 years, then there's a surplus. By this tool, and we'll have to discuss it with FinCom as part of the budget process, I would encourage us to spend more money on capital in the short term and less in the future. This will allow us to have a smaller deficit at the end, and we'll create a smaller structural deficit at the end of this, and given our capital plan, it's easily affordable. A quick journey into peer communities. We have 25 of them, statistically derived. You can see a lot of them are geographic, but not all of them. One thing that's very clear is, by former government, we do not include cities, so mayors are out. So Melrose is a lot like us, their mayor's a lot like me, but for this purpose, no, we don't talk to each other. We only look at towns. The tax levy in Reading, much as I just said, historically we've had to rely on it more and more. It's only 60% of our revenues. Our peer communities on average is 66% of their revenues. That's interesting. Residential, we're both bringing in about $54 million. Commercial, industrial, personal property is where there's the big difference. Reading brings in $5 million approximately. Our peers bring in $17 million. So that's where they beat us on revenue. They have another $12 million a year in revenue. Not to say they're the same size of us. They are a little larger. As a result of their commercial, industrial, personal property taxes, they don't rely on local receipts or state aid nearly as much. Now, that's kind of the dog wagging the tail. We also have a lot more students, so we have a lot more state aid. That's all part of the equation. Although our revenue picture is different, the way we spend money is very similar to our peers. You can see there's differences shown behind me, maybe a little bit more spending in some areas, maybe a little less in others. Public safety, specifically, we spend more because we offer advanced life support in the fire department, which brings in more revenue than that plus 0.5% over the average spending would indicate. They bring in $800,000. But by and large, you can see we're not spending in a very different pattern than our peers. And the first thing that was interesting to me was about was education, that we spend a little bit more, tiny bit more than our peers in education. But we don't, certainly don't per student. Here's the chart that shows the amount of enrollment. Reading at 17.4% of the population enrolled in the public schools. I mentioned earlier Stoneham, 10.7. This is why Reading has an above average amount of students, so while we spend an average amount a tiny bit more on education, as a percent of the budget, we do not per student. We spend below average per student. We have a lot of students. Here's what the residential taxpayer sees today. A $7,250 tax bill. $6,900 of that is the actual tax levy that would be subject to a Prop 2.5 override. Almost $350 are two pieces, the library and the high school, that will disappear over time. Those are excluded. If nothing else changed, the next 10 years, you can see in the chart behind me what the average single-family tax bill would do. It grows at 2.3% a year, below the 2.5, because of that excluded debt. One of them is level service and then goes away, the other one declines and then goes away. You can see in FY 25 and 26, the tax bill increase is particularly low because that's when each of the issues is fully repaid and goes away. From then on, this tax bill should go up 2.5% every year if nothing else changed. Over the 10 years, this is a 2% annual change. What do our peers do in terms of overrides? How do they look? The most relevant visual tool I found is to sort our peers by percent residential. So if you look at a few columns over, you see residential percentage. Milton at 96% has even more residential than Reading, which is 91.4. This data is a year old. Everything in yellow is a community that has done more overrides, has requested more overrides than Reading. Milton has requested 8, Winchester 10, and so forth, Reading only 5. The ones in yellow for most recent overrides are the community has requested an override since Reading last requested one, whether it passed or not. The column that says yes is those communities that have passed an override since Reading last did. And then a discussion that was held earlier, there's the tax classification, the splits. Winchester has an unusual single-family exemption, so they have actually a reverse split. You can see there's a number of 1.0s as Reading, but most of them are higher than that. But visually, what stands out in this chart is residential communities are more reliant on an override than non-residential communities, and that's intuitive. If you look at Burlington and look at the amount of commercial sector they have, and importantly, the amount of empty land they have to still develop, they don't need an override, they just need to keep building more things. Reading doesn't have that. When you don't have land available and you don't have a commercial sector, you cannot rely on that sector to grow the income the way you need to grow it. So communities that are bedroom communities, unfortunately, need to have overrides more than those that don't. The previous override was $4.5 million. As a percent of the tax base, that would be an $8.5 million override in FY 18, which was interesting. I was on FinCom at the time, and I looked back extensively through my notes and minutes. There was no modeling at all that was ever discussed, at least. There was a statement in one of the minutes, gee, I hope this lasts for 8 to 10 years. That's the only thing I could find looking to the future. So certainly the question to me is, why did the last one last so long? The superintendent and I sat down and discussed this slide once, and there's just too many things to put on the slide. We spent money, and largely through this body, in order to save money. You remember performance contracting, for instance, where we went out as the only community in Massachusetts, to my knowledge, went out and borrowed on its own in order to improve energy efficiency, which saved operating dollars. So we borrowed money, we saved money, and the savings goes on forever. The debt service gets repaid. We have an opt-out health insurance program where we split the savings 75-25 with our employees. They get 25% if they don't need our health insurance. We get 75% savings. We've saved a lot of money that way. We spend money to generate revenues, and the ALS system by the fire department is really the best example of that, bringing in, again, $750,000 a year. We spend a lot of time with operational efficiencies. That list is far too long. Our capital spending is right at the front. Again, 10, 15 years ago, we used to routinely spend $300,000 on DPW maintenance of equipment. We're now down to $200,000, and that's not inflation adjusted. That's 15 years later, we're actually spending less money. For one reason, we've got a much better capital fleet. We've both, the superintendent and I, have restructured single jobs as well as departments. We've done a lot of financial planning, and I'll come back to that. But to be fair, we have raised non-tax revenues. There's a lot more fees now than there was 10, 15 years ago. So while there's always room for improvement to that slide before where we're running out of ideas, it just is true. I love to have ideas. I'm just running low. Here's a simple example. In FY06, after the last override, the debt service inside the levy, this has nothing to do with excluded debt, was $4 million. The budget you passed in April had less than half of that. If we had the same debt service policy today that we did back then, we would have had to cut our school and town budgets by $4 million. So if you think back to the financial policy of the town not that many years ago, 10 years ago, it just did not consider enough debt service, and especially look at the cost of interest. Rates are lower, which certainly helps, but we issue far shorter debt than we used to. We repay it as quickly as we can. I was brought up that you don't borrow money unless you have to. A house is different. That's the only thing that's different. Everything else, if you can't afford it for cash, why are you borrowing it? The town takes the same approach. For a library, for a high school, it's fair to spread that cost over many years for different users. For everything else, pay it off quickly. So to look at the structural deficit, the selectmen then looked at additions, and this was the subject of a few meetings, including the school committee. Each side prepared lists of additions, in some cases budget restorations, and we came up to what would be a combined override of $9 million. So that set for the selectmen of parameters of $6 million to just balance the structural deficit and $9 million at the outside. And there's the dividing of how the budgets would be brought, divided between the town and the schools. And this would be the impact on the single family residential taxpayer. And just to be real clear, those numbers are additions above what normally would happen with Prop 2.5. So it is not the total tax implication, it is the additional taxes. 829 is the figure we've cited often. And it turned out the selectmen did choose the $7.5 million figure somewhat in the middle of that column, which does translate into an $829 above 2.5% tax increase. Again, the structural deficit of $6 million changed the 2% a year to just under 3%, and a $9 million would have made it 3.5%. What the selectmen voted was just over 3%. And this is what that will look like for the average single-family home for the next 10 years, again, if nothing changes. So you'll see a big jump in the first year with the override, and then you're right back to that same old pattern, 2.3%. Eventually, in a couple years, excluded debt is repaid, and then you go up to 2.5% a year. So none of that changes in the future. This is one-time revenue that comes into the town as an increase on a tax bill, and from then on, it's back to the old Prop 2.5% model. We looked at our residential tax burden, and looking at median family income, average was a little bit tricky because in every community, average is typically a higher number than median because of outliers in income especially. So we looked at median family incomes, and depending on how you do your math, you're $600 to $700 in Reading on a tax basis below average in the single family tax bill. We determined this about 2 years ago in working with FinCom, and I have to say I was surprised. I live here, I pay taxes, I didn't know what kind of a deal I was getting. But we are, several hundred dollars below average, no matter how you calculate it. You can just look to our north and see someone who's significantly over average, North Reading. The model that we've built, unlike perhaps what was done 13 years ago, gives a future town manager, a future town accountant, Board of Selectmen and School Committee, a way to measure how are we doing versus what was predicted in FY17. We can track it. We predicted accommodated cost growth. What's it really going to be? For those of you, and there's not many in the room that'll go back this far, Federal Reserve used to target money supply, and they had cones. And they measured inside the cone where you do. We do the same thing here. So we can really understand factually how long this override will last by the model we've built, unless we change the budget model and the discipline we have for spending. One thing I do want to mention, actually, too, none of this discussion tonight solves the problem of any large capital projects. So Killam has been discussed, and someday that will need a significant repair or replacement. DPW garage / cemetery building also needs some additional work. By FinCom policy, both of those would be brought forward as excluded debt to the taxpayers, so that is not on the table with this override. Those problems are not solved. And the other thing, back to my debt service example, we don't want to fall back into the pattern of doing things like Wood End School and Barrows renovation inside the tax levy. That's the reason the debt service was so large. That crowds out your operating budget. Debt service is not a valuable use of taxpayer money. Here's what the structural deficit looks like for the future. Right now we're getting, and this is just commercial, we had commercial, industrial, personal property, this is just the commercial sector. 206 properties, you can see they're $4.4 million of revenue. The highest end, the full $10 million plus six properties are all at Walker's Brook, five of the 12 in the next category at Walker's Brook. So it's fair to say Walker's Brook brings in about $2 million a year right now. That used to be the landfill. The selectmen, through myself and the planners, are targeting another $2 million of new growth through additional commercial development. That's the most we can imagine. $2 million would be great. It does not solve a $6 million structural deficit or a $7.5 million override. So for those that have suggested we grow ourselves out of it, remind yourself of that picture that I had with all the yellow. We don't have the land. We don't have the opportunity to grow ourselves out of this revenue need. At this point, I'll introduce the superintendent to go over the implications of both a yes and a no vote, and then I'll finish up and do the same.
Good evening, town meeting members. Thank you very much for staying for this important discussion. I know it's late, so I'm going to keep my comments brief, much briefer than what I did on September 1st. I do encourage you to access a document that is in the back of the room called the Rationale for FY18 Budget Discussion Items. This is a document that we put together at the school department to explain in detail the challenges that we are facing in our school district and the resources needed to address those challenges, as well as what will happen if an override passes and what will happen if an override does not. So I'm going to briefly go over some of what's in this document, but this document goes into it in much more detail. So, first of all, talking a little bit about the challenges, and the way we came up with these challenges is we've been having community discussions similar to what we've had as a community over the last few months. We've been having them with staff and school community parents for over a year now. And what we've identified are six major challenges. Unfortunately, in the last 3 years, these challenges have intensified because of changes that have been happening in education, but also the resources that Bob talked about earlier. So, and they range from retaining and attracting staff to making sure that we are able to retain the staff that we have, but also attract staff when positions become available. That is becoming more and more of a challenge over the last few years. We want to make sure also that our students are prepared when they leave Reading Memorial High School and either go to college, career, and for life. We want to make sure our teachers are supported and our administrators are supported as we transition to more rigorous standards of curriculum, which have been happening across the country over the last few years. We want to continue to improve our special education services in district. There are really two reasons for this. The first reason, which is more of a moral and ethical reason, is we want to make sure our students stay with their peers in our community. The second is financial. It is much more cost effective to educate our students in our school district, in our school buildings, with our staff, in with their peers, than it is to send them out to an out-of-district placement with tuition and transportation costs. One of the areas that is not addressed, but is a growing challenge, and Bob did allude to it a little bit, is the space needs of our district. The modular classrooms that town meeting approved last year have been very helpful. We continue to face those challenges as we continue to develop our special education programs and more families are choosing full-day kindergarten. And numbers 1 through 5 actually address number 6, is making sure that we remain competitive and comparable with other area school districts and other area schools, both from a staffing perspective and a student perspective. So as we identified these challenges, we also identified what are the resources that are needed. And the school committee a few weeks ago voted on this list of resources that that would be addressed if the override is passed. The first piece, which Bob talked to, is the structural deficit. That is the $2 million. That is really what it will take to fund the budget in FY18. Essentially, it's taking all of the staffing and services that we have currently in FY17 and moving them forward with normal contractual increases in not for just staffing but for other areas as well, including special education, bus transportation, things like that. The other areas are address the challenges that I just referred to, including salary adjustments, creating supervisory leadership to help support our staff, additional support for our struggling students. This is actually proactive in a way that in the long run it saves costs. Students that are struggling early on, if they do not get the attention that they need, usually end up on an IEP in special education, which has a greater cost to it. And right now, we don't have a lot of those services in our district. We also, as one of the items, special education leadership, again, to help support the growing and development of our special education programs, putting middle school health back into the middle schools. Unfortunately, this was reduced a couple of years ago out of the budget as part of some budget reductions. Putting back into place the two of the teachers that were reduced in the high school budget this year as a result of the budget cuts from FY17. And those are the areas that would total the amount of $2.96 million, which is the school department portion of the budget if the override passes. So what happens if the override does not pass? So one of the questions that's been asked to us is, well, can you just reduce expenses? And unfortunately, over the last few years, we have been trying to reduce expenses without cutting personnel. And this year, we actually had to cut 7.3 positions out of the budget to try to just reduce expenses and not personnel costs out of a very personnel-heavy budget is almost impossible to do. We figured that out of this, you probably could reduce the budget non-personnel expenses by about $300,000 of the $2 million. But a lot of those costs would be a one-time cost you could do for 1 year, but then you'd have to put them back in. Things like technology replacement, professional development for teachers, curriculum materials. Those things you probably could reduce for 1 year, but at some point you've got to put them back in. So you're solving the problem for 1 year, but it's not a long-term solution. So what we would be looking at if the override is not approved is it would be the fourth year in a row of making reductions from a level service budget. So our level service budget of 4 years ago has been getting reduced each of the last 4 years. Out of the $2 million that would be reduced, approximately 85% would be personnel. About $1.7 million of the $2 million would be personnel. And then the non-personnel would be the expenses that I just referred to. So potentially what we're looking at, and it would be a combination of teaching positions, support staff, and administrative positions, is you're looking at somewhere between 30 to 35 FTEs and reductions in that 1.7 of the $2 million reductions. Of course, any of the reductions that we're talking about here are going to have a significant impact on students. So here's the scope of the reductions if the override is not approved. And this isn't getting into specifics, but it talks about the magnitude of what we're looking at. So looking at teaching staff first, we're looking at 4 to 5 FTE at the elementary level, 12 to 13 FTE of support staff at the elementary level, 10 to 11 FTE of teaching staff at the middle school level, 3 to 4 FTE classroom teachers at the high school level. This will have an impact at each level in different ways. At the elementary level, it will be an increase of class sizes, ranging more to 25 to 28, depending on the level, K to 2 to 3 to 5, which right now it's 18 to 22 at K to 2. It's in the mid-20s from grades 3 to 5. In addition to the teaching staff, we'd also be making significant reductions to support staff that currently are employed at the elementary level. So that is going to have an effect on support for teachers and support for students, as well as support for administrators. At the middle school level, we're looking at 10 to 11 FTEs. It would have a significant impact on courses that are currently being offered at the middle school level. It would make a change to the middle school model that we currently have in place that is an age-appropriate model for addressing students at this developmental age. And it certainly would hurt in the progression of courses that a student can take as they go into high school. And at the high school level, there would have to be a shift in the graduation requirements, as we would have to be making reductions in courses that would be currently graduation requirement level courses. In addition to that, we'd also have some reductions at the administration level, which would be reduced support across the board for teaching staff, as well as for other administrators. Non-personal cuts would include curriculum funding, which would potentially be the second year of the science curriculum funding, which town meeting helped support this year. We'd also be looking at decreases in the building per pupil budgets, which is all of the materials and supplies for each of the buildings, the professional development for training of teachers, and technology replenishment when computers have reached the end of their cycle. So those would certainly be areas that would be affected if there was a $2 million reduction if the override was not approved. And as Bob mentioned, Killam is not part of any of the discussion right now, and also full-day kindergarten is not part of the reductions, not part of any of the discussion right now.
Thanks, John. One of the town meeting members that has since dearly departed, he just went home early, asked me to answer a question that has come up once or twice. I hope he only went home. Oh boy, am I going to be in trouble. The $7.5 million override has effectively, I'll say these pieces, $5 million is for the schools. $2 million is for the current structural deficit, as Dr. Doherty described. $1 million is for added backed services or new things. And $2 million is for a future expected structural budget deficit. It is not needed in the first year, but you saw that over 8 years, more than $2 million is going to be needed, so $2 million is kind of an average figure. And cut all those numbers in half and you get the town side. So just to be clear, the $7.5 million is $5 million on one side, $2.5 million on the other, roughly the 2-to-1 ratio that we talk about. On the town side, the addition's roughly a $500,000. We have the same issues as Dr. Doherty mentioned in retaining and attracting staff. By no means does anyone come to work for Reading because they'll be paid well. First of all, it's not the right public sector is not where you'd go to do that anyways, but nobody expects to come to Reading because at best we pay average. That's not why they come here. They come here for a lot of other reasons. But I will tell you, last summer, a year ago, it was very discouraging. We had about 25 empty positions on the town side of government. That's an all-time high. We were consistently being turned down by highly qualified people because we were $5,000 to $10,000 too low, and we just could not get there. I'm happy to say, in a perverse way, now we only have about 5 vacant positions. I've had to put a freeze on them because we might not be able to afford them. But thanks to this body largely over the last few years, you recall we've asked for some pay and class funding for non-union. That has made a big difference, not necessarily curing the $5,000 to $10,000 problem, but $2,000 to $3,000 and the support of town meeting and the selectmen go a long way to employees, making them understand they're appreciated in this town, and I do thank you for that. We have $200,000 more to go, and then we'll be happy. That'll retain and attract the right staff that we need. That's clearly the top priority. We'll add a school resource officer. We've discussed that internally, and certainly the middle schools and the elementary schools will get more attention. Another firefighter and paramedic. Technology equipment, and then probably technology staffing after that. The libraries need some more staffing. The town accountant needs some staffing, and our nighttime volunteer government needs better support. Unfortunately, the town is very frugal and doesn't like to spend money, but I guarantee you that list could be $2 million based on all the ideas I heard. Oh, an override. This is wonderful. These are all the things we could do. We can't. Most of the override is just to keep our heads above water. I do like to think that if we keep working hard every year, we can add some other things from time to time, and I would expect we would. But some things that did not make this list are very important. They're just not something we can put up right on the front. Here's what happens if an override fails, and next April you have to see a town budget. And this is by no means a specific example. This is an illustration. The town budget is much more expense-heavy than the school budget. We have less personnel as a ratio. When Dr. Doherty mentions 30 to 35 positions, we do have the 2-to-1 ratio, but that really translates to less than 15 positions on the town side because we do have more expenses. This is a simple example. If every department did a pro rata reduction employment-wise using a 75-25% wage expense split, 11 FTEs would need to be eliminated from the budget. And I will tell you point blank that Town Hall has borne the last 4 years of budget balancing. That's primarily administrative services, public services, finance, and a portion of DPW. That cannot balance the next set of budget cuts that are needed. The public library and public safety have been protected in the past. They will not be protected anymore. They cannot be protected anymore. So you will absolutely see cuts in public safety. In library, you'll see less hours, although there's a possibility, even with a failed override in the first year, they may not have to do that. I guarantee you they will in the second year of a failed override. And likewise, you know, you can see an illustration. And to be real blunt about it, you saw the chief appraiser here earlier. He's only half of a person. We share him with Wakefield. We've regionalized some positions. We've tried to do more, and they didn't work out so well. We've tried job sharing internally with two things that don't always match and make sense. We've done as much as we can, and we're really at the point now that if we're going to cut things at Town Hall, for instance, and if you remember that peer spending slide, Town Hall is the one area that we're the weakest in spending, and that's okay. We are going to eliminate services. We are not going to reduce them. We are not going to ask staff to be more clever. Services will be gone. And from those 21 public meetings that we've had over the summer, we have still not come up with anyone who uses a service that's willing to get rid of it. This body will have a very tough budget in front of it, and I'm not advocating for an override. We'll do what the taxpayers want, but this body is going to have a very difficult budget to look at when this body sees what reductions need to be made and services eliminated in addition to staffing be eliminated. If you think hard and long about what the town does, we're all going to have slightly different opinions on this. but there are essential functions of a government, and then there are nice parts of the government. And I'll leave that to you as to there's things that the town of Reading does that make Reading Reading. We can't afford to do those without an override forever. So thank you. I'd welcome any questions and comments, and I really do appreciate the fact you stayed this late.
Mr. Sylvester. Could you use the microphone, Mr. Sylvester? Could you use the microphone?
Thanks.
I have a question with respect to the structural deficit. And in the past, the way we've tried to fix that is by using free cash. Now, we know we cannot continue doing that. We, you know, and you had a slide up a little bit earlier which showed the increasing amount of free cash. But I think in what I've seen with the override prospect, that the free cash spending has gone to zero. Is that not what I have seen? That we see a rising structural deficit from 2 million to 3 million, and all 3 million went into the override. So,
yeah, we've had two different models out there, and we've shown them both. One is a modest use of free cash, defined as 750,000 to a million, pick one, and one is zero. If an override fails, it's up to FinCom what they will do. I will ask them to use $1 million of free cash. They may or may not wish to use $1 million. I would argue, and I know in past FinComs have agreed, that there's some amount of free cash that we can reliably regenerate every year through not spending all of town meeting's allocation and some revenues that come in a little higher. But beyond the $750 to $1 million range, that's just dumb luck when we regenerate more than that. And we've had a lot of it.
I would not pretend to advocate anything more than
right.
that.
Right. So you've seen the structural deficit model that suggests $6 million will take care of the next 8 years assumes $1 million of free cash is used, just so you know that.
My concern is that the first year tax bill after an override is a whopping big change for the average homeowner. We're talking something on the order of, you know, $1,000 when everything is said and done between the normal 2.5 increase, the roughly $800 increase from the override, and the additional money which we have allocated for property tax relief. That's a big nut to swallow in an economy that has really not been growing that well. And the same problems that plague the town with respect to health care costs and benefits increases are also hitting our taxpayers. And anything we can do to reduce that, you know, certainly would be a help, even if it were such that we would, you know, phase in, you know, the increases over time. Yes, you may still need to go for a $7.5 million override, but it doesn't mean you need to collect all of that necessarily on year one and year two. I mean, even, you know, breaking it up into an additional $350 increase each year is certainly more palatable than, you know, than a grand.
We talked about this extensively last winter. Some of it is tax policy as allowed by the Commonwealth, and some is the appetite of the voters to believe what the selectmen say, with no disrespect. You could have the voters approve a large override and promise not to assess it in the first year, second year, third year. That's a promise that the selectmen, through their tax policy, are not obliged to keep. They may not. So, you know, we did think about that and think, you know, why don't we ask for a bigger number but not actually use it all up front? And the other alternative is what's behind me, is we could also ask much more often, and then the number would be smaller. And that's a philosophical question where I don't think there's a right answer. But if you look behind, we've asked for 5 times, and some communities have asked for 10 to 20 times over the same period of time. There's not a right and a wrong answer there, but after discussion, it was thought that, well, this is the way Reading prefers to do business. That doesn't make it right. But if we asked more often than every 13 years, certainly the ask would be smaller. No question about that.
Yeah, right behind. Yes. O'Rourke.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. I guess just some comments. So I think all of us share one common perspective. No one likes an override. Even the word itself is problematic, but I think from listening tonight and I think previous town meetings, I think we knew it was coming. It's long overdue. I think it's pretty clear the funding can only come from property taxes, at least the significant amount that's needed. I'd also say, to me, it's an issue of competitiveness for the town, certainly for our school systems. I thought it was enlightening, I think, as in our own business, when you have 25 positions open that you can't fill, that speaks to, I still think we get some of the best and brightest, but certainly we're not getting a lot of the best and brightest. I think that's just obvious. And it's the desirability, I think, you know, those of us who have lived, which is most of us here tonight, I'd say, lived in Reading for a long time. It's a very nice town to live in. We made a decision to raise our families here, and I guess that brings me to the other point. It's a lot of us just looking around don't have kids in the school system, I'd venture to say, but we did. And so some of it's, you know, being willing to do what the parents and grandparents and founding fathers already did for our children is provide a nice place for them to go to school and to be able to compete and go to great schools and earn a living, hopefully even in Reading. I guess the final thing I'd say, you know, there's a lot of people that don't have the benefit of what we just sat through, and even though there was more than enough meetings, I think there's a challenge for all of us to communicate as town meeting members and as citizens the urgency, because it doesn't take too many failed overrides to get in a position where it takes a long time to recover, and maybe you never totally recover. So I challenge all of us to do what we can to help support this, not just personally, but amongst our community members. Thank you.
I'd like to point out that there is, first of all, in general, there's far too much information available about this to be digested. But the town has endeavored and will continue in the next week or so to consolidate and condense that information. There is a section on the town's website. If you go to the left-hand side, there's a button that says override or something like that. There's a section under the assessors that's just a wealth of information, presentations and so forth. And what some staff, we've hired one of our staff members actually is a former newspaper editor, so she's pretty good at communication. Bite-sized information for people to understand that they're in too much of a hurry. They can't sit through this. They can't sit through anything in the summer and read long articles. They need to have a couple pages that sums it up, and that will be, it's already available, but it'll be improved. So the website should be a pretty good tool for the person that doesn't have much time.
Mr. Doxer.
Welcome to the late show. My name is Mark Doxer. I'm the chair of the FinCom, and what I was hoping to do in a total of five slides is give you a little bit of kind of our perspective from the discussions that we've been having about it. So, thank you. Get us started here. Awesome. Thank you. So, very quickly, the folks that are town meeting members, others who aren't aware, what we do at the FinCom is we look at the town and the school budgets each year. We review the state of our revenues, the services that are being offered. We scrutinize the budget, and then we bring forward a recommendation. And as many people have just mentioned, we look at, over the last several years, we've been highlighting that the structural deficit is upon us. And we've been talking to town meeting, and Mr. O'Rourke just mentioned it as well. So it's not something that's new. It's existed, and we've indicated it needs some action. For fiscal 18, we are very much at that point. And that point means either sharply reduced spending in the future, which you've just heard about, or new revenue in the form of an override. We talked a little bit about free cash. Again, most of the folks who are still here, I think, have a pretty good handle on what free cash is. But think of it as kind of a rainy day fund. It's best used to fund surprises, things like snow and ice when they really happen, or to support some one-time priorities. But over the last few years, we've actually used $1.5 to $2 million of free cash each year to balance the budget. It is not something that we want to keep doing on a broad basis. It really is something that should be used for expenses that, or excuse me, it should not be used for things that are recurring. The operating budget is a recurring activity. In fact, it's frowned upon to use a whole bunch of it. If you think about what's going on, if you spend $2 million in free cash from 1 year, you need the next year to do the same thing again and again and again. So think of it as if you added people or replaced people, you have to kind of keep supporting that. So it's not just a one-time use when you use it for the operating budget. So where are we now? We talked about not using it going forward. It's not sustainable. We recently had some meetings where we talked about our policies of how much free cash we think we need to hold. The past policy that we've had for 10-plus years, probably more like 20, has been 5%. That's been our target to hold at all times. We recently have been talking about increasing that amount, and at our last meeting, we voted to increase it to 7% of the revenues of the town. As I mentioned before, or I'm sorry, it was on the slide, our certified free cash was about 10% of revenues as of last year, July of 2015. It's a good position from our point of view. The bond rating agencies really like it, and that's why we maintained a AAA rating. In fact, it's a higher rating than state and federal government have. And that gave us the opportunity to get bonds at 1.26%. That level of free cash is also very similar to what other peer communities are holding at this point. It's not like we're an outlier holding this amazing amount of free cash. We also had some discussion about at what point, if we fell below 7%, we'd want to have further discussions and feel that we have some jeopardy. We decided that number was back to the 5% that we had before. So what we're saying is that we want to be holding more free cash than we were before for these one-time activities and special needs. What's also been brought up is that we may have a liability from some litigation, and we'd like to have some amount of free cash available that could help support that activity, you know, if it comes to fruition. I hate to call it fruition, but if it happens. So we have taken a look at the materials that have been put together in terms of the models that have been shared with you and some of the assumptions that have been built into that model. From our point of view, we think these assumptions are pretty reasonable. We've made some updates to them based on recent history, looking at what's happened to revenues and expenses, what's happened in terms of regeneration. So we think that the model looks pretty good, it's the best assumption that we can make. But because we've updated it, that also means the likelihood of good surprises, pulling something out of the rabbit out of the hat or something like that, those are going to get harder and harder to find and pretty much unlikely to happen going forward. We think that the structural deficit as defined, the $6 million number that we're talking about over the course of the time frame of the override, is reasonably represented. We don't have any issues with that number. And bottom line, we think that the Selectmen's proposal for the $7.5 million override and the usage as expressed by both the school committee and the towns is financially responsible in terms of how to fund the priorities they've laid out. And that's five slides. Thanks.
Further discussion? Yes, right over here.
Jeffrey Corum, Precinct 7. It's a little late to get into the details of it, but I'd like to see maybe on the town website some further explanation of how the increase in capital expenses for the beginning portions would help us deal with things as things go on. And I'm also struggling to understand how accelerating the capital would help us in terms of, like, if I know my roof needs to be replaced in 10 years, but I do it in 5, then I've just, you know, lost the 5 years of the roof that I could have gotten out of it. So I'm not sure how that's saving the town money. So I don't know if tonight or you could post that on the website to explain in more detail how that shifting of the capital is going to help us out.
This is the most illogical part of the whole discussion. I've struggled with it. The basic philosophy is simple. We need to ask the taxpayers once for a lump sum of money. And we know the problem is not a lump sum thing that can be fixed. So by definition, that says we're going to ask you for a little more than we need in the first year, and we're going to need to save some of that, and so forth for roughly half the period, and then we're going to use it in the second half. We could do that. We could take $3 million more or less out of the 7.5, not quite, and put it in the bank. Yeah. And then in the end, we're going to be using that $3 million in the last year, and the hole we're going to have dug ourselves at the end is larger than the one we're in. That's okay. We'll just ask for another override. That's one approach. If you recall, I also mentioned how capital appears to have a surplus in years 6 through 10. To my surprise, I've looked at it many times, but it really does. That means that we potentially don't have to spend as much on capital, if that's true, at some point. I looked at the capital needs in years 1 to 5 and thought, maybe we just push that all out and spread it out and make it smaller. Some of the things are really important to have, like fire engines. We're on a schedule. We have to keep to that. A lot of it is facilities-related, roofs. You can never tell exactly what the break-even of should I have done the roof last year or next year is, but if you get it wrong, it's kind of a big problem. But I do feel very comfortable that after 4 or 5 years, we're in a really, really good position in our capital, and we don't have to spend as much. Okay, so we could put $3 million in the bank and then do less. We also have this unknown amount of litigation to pay for, and I look at that as capital. It's a building project. The building project potentially could have a larger charge, and it's capital. So that's another unknown number of capital that's not in the capital plan that you know might come out in a year from now. If instead of just spending, instead of just saving $3 million, we could use it productively. We can do things in facilities, and that's the primary reason, that'll again reduce operating costs sooner than it otherwise would have happened. We should do that. That's going to cause in the future us to be spending less capital than otherwise would have been the case, but I've already told you that's okay. So instead of building a large operating budget cliff in the future, we're making that a smaller one and taking a bite out of future capital, which we don't need. It's not intuitively obvious. You really have to sit and think about it, and this was the hardest part for me to solve, and it's really hard to explain. But if we had actual numbers, for instance, for litigation, I could lay it all out and make a great deal of sense of it. As it is now, I've identified capital absent that we can spend in the first couple of years that will save us money in the operating budget, and that's always a good thing. But you're right. To the extent there's equipment that follows a replacement cycle or parts of buildings that follow replacement cycles, you don't necessarily want to speed that up. We don't want to buy an extra fire engine now when we don't really need one for 5 years, so we wouldn't be suggesting doing things like that.
More discussion? Yes.
Hi, Erin Calvo-Bacci, Precinct 5. I have 3 questions. My first is in regards to the educational state mandates that are not paid for by the state. What is the penalty to us if we do not adopt them?
Mr. Daugherty?
So my understanding is that there's certain things, the mandates by the state, but we're not receiving any money. So is there a way that we can not adopt them, or in a pushback to get the state to give us that money?
Well, we won't get the state to give us the money. I'll tell you that. Right now, our Chapter 70 funding is at the foundation level, so what we get is what's called the hold harmless amount, which is about $25 additional per student, which is why the graph that Bob showed that our state aid has been going up at a lower percentage. If you can give me an example of a mandate that we wouldn't implement. So there's a lot of different laws and regulations that we're required to do, ranging from special education law to implementing the curriculum frameworks. Obviously, some things you do are more serious than others. It could result in litigation.
Okay.
For example, special education, if you do not implement and follow special education law, it's going to result in litigation.
Okay.
So that's not a road we want to go down. If for some reason tomorrow we decide we're not going to be implementing the the curriculum frameworks, which we have been putting in place now for 5 years, that's going to result in lower state assessment scores, mm-hmm. Because those are linked to your state testing park, which are now MCAS 2.0. So the state has these what they call mandates, but they are linked to other things like assessment or requirements that you have to do for students as part of the law, things like that. Like, I'll give you another example. English language learners were required to provide so many services. Again, if we don't provide those services, it ends up in litigation, and those students are not as successful.
Now, in regards to the advisory program, has that been cut, or are you saying that will be cut?
It was eliminated this year.
Okay, because as a parent of a child that went through that, it was something that I would have rather see her in another class. And even when I had to go as a parent to sit with the conference, and I asked a question about what is the usefulness of this, will this now carry on through the school year, they said no, it was just for the freshmen. And the teacher did say, it's really not necessarily for my type of child student, it's for others. So maybe those are other areas that we can be looking at, that it's unfortunate that maybe it is helpful for some, but if we're looking at overall all the different classes available to our students, you know, it's unfortunate, but I don't think that's as big an issue as if you're talking about cutting AP courses. And then my other...
Yeah, that was reduced this year.
Yeah. And then my other question is in regards to Killam. Killam's not part of this override, but we know that Killam has issues in regards to ADA, fire codes, lead. My first question about Killam is, how much are we paying for, how much are the water coolers costing the town right now at Killam?
The coolers themselves are actually free, which is paying for the bottled water itself. It's a minimal cost. Right now, I think it's a novelty and it's hot out, so we're using more. I think over the year, when you spread it out, it's not going to be a significant amount of money. It's certainly a cheaper option going in this direction right now and creating just hand washing only at the sinks than doing something differently. At some point, we are going to have to do something long-term to kill them. With the water situation.
And especially, I mean, we're talking about a whole community and where we're looking at our seniors. Unfortunately, the town meeting body voted in favor of the library instead of giving the money that's really needed to kill them. So we're also seeing a community school that's not getting its fair share when we're looking at the whole town. So when is Killam going to... When do you foresee Killam getting the work that it needs, whether it means building a whole new school, and what is that estimated cost to this town? Is that going to be an additional override? And at what point? Is that a few
it's
years?
It's
going to
depend on the scope of the work that's done on Killam. My guess is it will require a significant, you know, amount. And it depends what the direction we're going to go in, and that really is a decision. It's going to be more of a community decision that would involve the building committee. The school committee would be a part of that as well.
And that's really something that, as a body, everyone really needs to be aware that that's a cost that we are going to be facing in addition to this override. So it's not just this override. Everyone really needs to be mindful that that is going to be a major cost. So thank you.
Further questions?
I'd just like to follow up. For those of you that don't know, you have a very creative board of selectmen, and they're constantly saying, what if we didn't follow the law? What if we broke the law? Fortunately, town council's gone now. He's usually one that doesn't like to hear that. But just as an example, when the library moved into its temporary space down at One General Way, we could have built out the space, or the landlord could have built out the space under the laws we have to operate, it would have cost us 50-70% more to do it as a town than the landlord did. So guess what? The landlord did it. There are so many things that tie municipalities' hands when it comes to public construction and building buildings. It would have been much better if someone else had built the library for us and then sold it to us, because we could have saved millions of dollars. That's a problem with this Commonwealth. That's something that I'm constantly on our reps for, but those are the rules. And to John's earlier point, you start breaking those rules, you're going to rack up some serious legal bills. But by no means can we operate efficiently given some of the rules that we face. We do the best we can.
Any more questions? Seems to be it. Mr. Halsey, your meeting? Was there another question? Oh, I'm sorry. In the back.
Gary Phillips, I do appreciate the latitude that a session like this allows. I'd just like to get right to the point in expressing what I think is a minority opinion when it comes to public meetings. And pardon me, bear with me as I do my best to formulate my thoughts. I'd just like to give you some reasons why I think any attempt at an override is going to fail. First of all, a good many voters in town see a big difference between school department needs and townside needs and feel a lot differently about them both. As someone who went out to get signatures as a town meeting member, I told people right up front, I'm fiscally conservative, socially conservative. I think public education has become too much about power and control, ask any union member, and less about education. Public education had become too much of a money grab. And
can you stick to the issue of the override, please?
Sorry?
Can you stick to the issue of the override?
That's exactly what I'm doing. And if you want to understand, if you want to understand why there is such a big divide in all these public meetings, an overwhelming majority of the town officials and the attendees are pro-override. Why is it these attempts fail at the ballot box? I'm telling you why right now. And if you don't want to listen to this minority opinion, you're going to go on applying the same defective approach in your thinking. Again, there's a big difference in our sentiments toward townside needs. Let me just delineate a little bit. We all need our roads plowed in the winter. We need good roads. We need disposal. These are the things that we all need, the basic needs. It's a consumer-driven service. We all support that. But when a lot of us look at the school department, I'll state it as succinctly as I can, an increasing number of us are simply losing faith in public education. That's the big picture. This is what people are responding to. When I talk to people about the school department and wasted millions on building school projects, defective curriculum, bingo. I have one guy say, go next door and speak to my neighbor. I'm going to call him and tell him, sign for this guy. When we stand by year after year and watch things like this, and people want to shut me down with, Mr. Moderator, point of order, this is an editorial. They don't want to hear it when we say, you post it up on the wall there and tell us you have space needs? After the school department that we trusted went out and tore down a high school, reduced capacity by 20 classrooms, and Mr. Moderator, we don't want to hear that. These are naysayers. Well, when we trusted them with our money, we came up short in the end. And they performed in such a way that they really perpetuated a never-ending need for more.
Again, you're straying into personalities here. You want to talk about the issue,
so
that's fine.
I'm telling you this. This is why any old proposal for an override, I'll give you a positive solution, okay, a suggestion. Because a lot of us feel differently about the two sides of government, areas of town government, I would suggest in the future that you present separate appropriation articles, one for the town side, one for the school side. And I think that would do a lot to go ahead and show how people feel about one versus the other. And it would give them a voice. Because frankly, we have little to no voice when it comes to public education except to give a blank check. Because as everyone knows, we only have bottom line authority. Once we agree with that final figure, they can shuttle from one line item to another, move funds around however they choose, but we don't feel the same way toward the town. We watch the selectmen agonize at their appropriation meetings over one line item after another. You listen to a school department session on the budget, and it's like a philosophy session, you know? And it's nothing that really is binding when it comes to the details. We don't have that kind of control over one versus the other. So a lot of us are evaluating Townside as consumers, and we say we're getting the product we pay for. We look at public education. We see massive mistakes when it comes to building projects. We see deficiencies in our performance. I understand our town's rating when it comes to testing has gone down since what year, especially? You can tell us, 2000. It's gone down considerably, and we've seen nothing but a disproportionate increase in appropriation and spending in public education. And let me sum it up with one closing suggestion. For those who really care about education first versus control, because that's really the question, we suggest that we start considering a tax rebate for every parent who takes their kids out of public schools and sends them to private facilities, so that every year they do so, it'll do two things. It'll produce competition. It will go ahead. It will be fair to help subsidize better education by giving those parents rebates, and it will reduce this monopoly the unions have on public education. But I'm telling you, this is the way a lot of people feel, like it or not, and if you don't recognize that distinction and how people feel about one side of government versus the other, then I think you're going to be making a mistake, at least in how you present the appropriation articles to town. But I hope it made sense to some of you. Thanks.
Mr. Halsey?
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. Any other questions directly related to the override itself, directly related to any of the material that's been presented? I want to thank everybody that's been here and be sure that we clarify anything that's left unsaid in your mind. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Kendra Cooper. An area that I don't really see a lot of information on has to do with, and John Doherty raised a question about, you know, he said that sped litigation, that, you know, if we don't follow what the requirements are, then that results in litigation. And what I don't really know is how much money do we spend on litigation when it comes to special ed cases and where people have had to go to litigation because their IEPs haven't been followed.
Is there a line item?
I'm just kind of wondering because I know in previous years. Okay.
Yep.
And it would be on litigation. So combined with that, it's called what?
Legal fees.
Oh, legal fees, yeah. But at the same time, the other thing I've been hearing about.
So that you don't get confused. Special ed legal fees isn't just for special education. It's for any student service.
Okay.
For example, when we want to get our handbooks reviewed, which we have to on a regular basis, to make sure that legally they are accurate, we use our student lawyer, who is also our special education lawyer. So
it's rolled in.
It's not just special education legal fees.
It's not litigation. It's a combination of
correct.
All of those topics. And,
correct.
Okay, yeah. So we really don't know how much is the result of litigation, the result of, say, failed following of IEPs or anything like that. It's not broken down like that. Is that information that we can possibly have that we can access? It gives us an idea of how much is litigation and how much is, for example, your policies. I'm just trying to understand where are areas where we could, you know, we could be saving money. And particularly, I noticed in this tonight's program, the RMHS construction litigation, and we really don't have, you know, much information on that.
Well, and you won't have more information on that other than to say that there is ongoing litigation that is now.
Well, we
eight
must
or
know
nine
how
years
much
old.
We've spent already.
We know what the legal fees are, but we do not know what the settlement will be. And so,
right.
you know,
Well, what have we spent already on the legal fees? I mean, just for us, this has to do with the retaining wall.
You know,
right?
First of all, we want to stay on topic here. And the topic is about the override, about the special election and the override. And frankly, the litigation that's pending is really not inclusive in the override.
My impression is that that's part of why we need the override. Is that
wrong?
No,
it is not. It is absolutely.
It has nothing to do with that.
Our considerations did not take that into account. It really is a totally separate topic that at the moment is unknown. What is unknown and some things that need to be unsaid is because during negotiations of litigation, there are certain things that need to remain in executive session so that your negotiating position stays as strong as possible. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
Well, as a town meeting member, I'm just trying to understand all the facets that,
sure,
that
I understand,
are coming
yes.
toward this, and as well as you specifically put in this background the RMHS construction litigation. So I'm assuming that would have a bearing on the override.
Well, it doesn't. Okay, let's just clarify. Everything that you saw in the figures that were put up by the town manager were tied not in one way at all to any pending litigation that might be attached to RMHS. Totally separate. He commented on the fact that when it comes will be a capital expense, and a capital expense really has nothing to do with those things that we considered when we looked at a dollar amount for the override. They're really tied to, the structural inefficiencies of the tax system, the way it works, frankly, and what we're trying to do is the best we can to make it work for us. As expenses rise and our ability to raise revenues either diminishes or flatlines, ultimately what you see with a Proposition 2.5 tax system is that it will crash and burn. Mm-hmm. And it's just a question of when it's going to crash and burn. And so what we've been able to successfully do for quite a long period of time is extend the period where we wouldn't come back for an override. I think one of the most telling slides that was up there that the town manager put up was showed that many of our peer communities have had as many as 20 overrides in a period 20 override attempts in a period of time that we've had 5. So we've taken a little different look towards it. Maybe that's shame on us. Maybe what we should have done is not be as efficient and not be as money saving, but nonetheless, that's the way that was done. So for purposes of the rest of this evening, I think what we've tried to do is create as much transparency as possible. There has been 21 public meetings surrounding these topics.
And I have attended some of those meetings and watched them on cable.
And it's great that you've been able to. And right. I don't.
And I think it's very important that cable has been able to cover some of these.
I think the goal of tonight was to create as much transparency as is humanly possible. In reviewing other overrides in the town of Reading, what we discovered was there was little or no discussion. It was like, here's the deal. We're going to do this. Or we're going to do that.
When was that? You mean 13 years ago?
Yes.
Oh, but 13 years ago, I just went online last night to see. 13 years ago, there was a group called Informed Residents of Reading. That's IROR.org.
Yes.
And I went online, and it's still up there. And it's very interesting to look back at the details and to look back at the documents and even testimony by Christine Lynch, who is school building assistants, when we're kind of back to that kind of thing again. So there was a lot more going on than I think there is at all with what's going on right now with this proposed.
In the way of information.
Of the way of information, absolutely.
Well,
and
yeah.
But we can get along, but go on, iroar.org.
I have a famous clip and quote still on that website not an employee.
I was surprised.
So you should
to
look
it
for it. It's quite entertaining. Yeah. But to be clear, that was not put forward by your town government. That was a private group of people.
That was residents. So it's almost like the group.
So what John is mentioning
first.
And what I said earlier is the amount of public information and public meetings held by your town government school committee did not exist as it has this year, ever.
Yeah.
The last time there was an override, albeit the wisdom of the community was a little more in tune because it had been a failed override and the consequences that everyone could see, Richard Foley, the prior town accountant and school business administrator, looked at all the budget requests in late January and said, uh-oh, we got a problem. There was a financial forum called in the last week of January. There was an override in April. That's how fast it happened with two public meetings in between.
Yeah.
Big difference from us standing in front of you for years saying, this is where we're heading, this is where we're heading.
There was more press, too. There was a whole lot more.
There was much more private involvement, I guess I'll say, back then.
Right.
And we haven't seen a lot of it this time by comparison. You'd be right about that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, to kind of wrap this up, we hope that this has been helpful for you. We hope it's been informative. The selectmen stand ready to follow the wishes of the voters. The voters are going to tell us what our job is going forward. It's going to be to work with the override amount, or it's going to be to work with what we have without the override amount. And it's been our goal over the course of the last year to be as informative to each and every person as we can and to represent all interests as best we can. And so we're kind of at that place now as we close in on the time of the special election that the voters will tell us what it is they want us to do next. And we thought it was important and a good courtesy to the town meeting to let you understand our thought process, how we got to the, you know, to the decisions we made to put this in front of the voters. And so we hope that this has been helpful for you. You are the elected town, you know, you are the elected town officials that ultimately decide how taxpayers' money gets spent. And so they may look to you for your opinion and thought. And with that in mind, we hope that we've provided that to you. So at that point, we're going to close this discussion. I'll ask the selectmen if they have anything else on their mind. And I'll entertain a motion. All those in favor? 5-0. We stand adjourned. School committee? Okay, they lost their quorum. They're adjourned. Okay, we're done. Thank you very much for sticking around and listening.